Hi guys. Okay, so we are live and I am with Laci Green, which a lot of people had a lot of opinions about. I started promoting this 2 days ago and it's just gone crazy. So say hey, Laci.
Hey, thank you so much for having me on your channel and to the audience. I actually can't see the conversation, just a heads up, because it's distracting, but thank you for what I will assume is a very warm welcome.
Yeah, for sure. You know, I don't really watch the chat half the time. I feel like it just distracts you and there's a lot of crazy stuff going on. But
And I'm here to talk to you.
Yeah, for sure. And honestly, you know, I don't have a whole lot of, you know, crazy expectations for this talk other than it being a fluid conversation in which we both talk about our ideas and we can clash, but it'll be peaceful. And what do you think of kind of the last 2 days that I posted we're gonna do this, like all the different things people have been saying and expecting this to be?
Well, the internet's always a really fun place for vibrant conversation. The tweets that I did catch, you know, like I was talking to you before we went live, I feel like, you know, people put you and I into boxes in a sense, and a lot of people seem suspicious that I was like approaching you to trap you into something, or like I was gonna try to pull a fast one on you. And I just like, maybe I've like fucked up and been like that on the internet before. I can't really recall it, but I just don't know where those assumptions come from. And I'm hoping that, you know, you and I can have a chat. And yes, we have disagreements. We also have a lot of agreements. And that's kind of the fun of talking about these things for me, is kind of navigating the nuances of these conversations.
Yeah. And you know, you and I operate in a lot of ways, very opposite spheres of the internet. You know, feminist YouTuber, anti-feminist YouTuber. I think we both voted different ways in the election. We won't talk about that. But you know, so I think these conversations,
Another day. That's a whole other ball game.
this is our introduction. We'll do that later. But you know, a lot of people anticipated this to be some like WWE SmackDown. I don't know if that's the right terminology. I'm not into wrestling. but really, it's just a conversation. So I guess we'll start out by me asking you, because what sparked this conversation was you following me, which I originally tweeted you and I was like, girl, was this like an accident? Like, you're following me? This, it shocked me, you know?
That was funny. I lulled.
Yeah. And you tweeted me and said that you've been watching my content and you agreed with some things and were confused about others. So I think people will be interested to hear you elaborate on what you agreed with, what you're confused about, et cetera.
Yeah. Okay. So, you know, I want to back up real quick and just make two quick requests. You kind of already covered one of them, which is asking those of you who are observing this conversation to avoid the temptation of framing this as one of us here to own or debate. I mean, maybe there's a little natural debate in these things, but you know, this sort of like, I need to own someone, and there's this sort of violent element, as you've expressed with the WWE. I don't feel like I wanted to talk to you. That's why I tweeted you. I don't want to like convert you to my feminist cult, as some people have said. Okay, so that also, the other request that I have is, you know, I am a feminist and I hold feminist opinions, but I really want to make sure that, I'm sure you already know this, Blaire, but people who are observing this, feminists, non-feminists, and everyone in between, I'm not a spokesperson for feminism, all right? I'm not here to like speak on behalf of feminists, on behalf of feminism, on behalf of any particular ideology. I'm here to speak for me. And that's really, really important because a lot of feminists may disagree with the things that I'm going to say. people can just, you know, disagree about a lot of things. And I think that's why it's important to reiterate that it's for me only, all right? It's me and Blaire, not like grand ideologies.
Absolutely.
So my confusion when I tweeted you, well, I've watched so many of your videos now that I guess there's a lot of things. But you know, one of the reasons why I reached out is because I feel like when I watch your videos, as opposed to maybe some other videos that I've seen in the, I don't know if you'd call yourself like anti-social justice warrior. Like, is there a term for like the genre of video that you make? just to...
People debate on that so much. You know, I've never labeled myself, but I guess what's safe to say in the context of this talk is, like, I have an anti-feminist channel, especially in comparison to yours, which is feminist.
Okay. So would you like me to call it, like, refer to it from here on as anti-feminist?
Sure.
Okay. Just for, like, the sake of simplifying what we're talking about. Okay. So, you know, when I watch anti-feminist videos, a lot of the time I don't feel like they have a clear logic or coherence to them. And with yours, I think there is. And I think that there is, I also see in you sort of an ability to see the nuances and arguments. And I also feel like your perspective and where you come from is really interesting in terms of how it's shaped your perspectives. And we are both very opinionated women on the internet. And that makes it, I think, I identify with you in some way because of that, because I feel like our YouTube experience is probably not that far off. Like, there are obviously differences, but we have, I think there's some similarities there. I want to parse out the confusion in our main topics today. I don't necessarily have a specific question for you, but in particular, I'm interested in talking to you about your experiences with feminism and kind of how your perspectives on that have been informed. I've been watching your videos about what sounds like some really fucked up, terrible people. I want to hear more about that and kind of how it's informed your transgender politics, because you are a transgender activist, and talking about gender more generally. And kind of, I think we have different approaches to gender, and I'm curious about that.
Yeah, I think in a lot of ways, the way we approach and view and talk about gender on our channels are opposite. But there are some similarities, of course.
I don't know if we're opposite. We'll get there, Blaire. I don't think we're opposites. I think we have, like, we have shared ground and some divergence.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good way to put it. So, I mean, as far as my experience with feminism, I think that the way I differ from a lot of the other anti-feminist YouTube channels, obviously not all, but a lot of them, is that I've actually had quite a bit of experience with feminist activism in real life, not being one myself, but being surrounded by it. Being trans, I think it's easy in your teenage years to surround yourself with a certain type of people, because on the surface, those kinds of people are going to be the most accepting of you. And I will say that on the surface, feminists really are the most accepting of trans people. I think when you really get down to it, they do more harm than good to trans activism and trans people, but we'll get into that as well. Mm-hmm. And so I found myself in this very large social circle with a lot of feminists, a lot of what we refer to you as social justice warriors. And so kind of my experiences with them have shaped my views on it, having had firsthand experience, rather than, I feel like a lot of channels are people, you know, from wherever they're from, and they talk about it because it's more of like they want to wreck feminists online and they want to be, you know, win internet points. But for me, I started my channel desperately frustrated with feminism, because being trans, I feel like it was always shoved down my throat, and there were aspects of it that I saw were very contradictory to transgender people. Things like arguing that gender is a social construct while simultaneously saying that trans people are born with, you know, the opposite brains. Mm-hmm. And then some feminists often say that there are no differences between male and female brains, which is false. I actually saw, like, a video you did on that I kind of want to talk to you about. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I definitely want to talk about brains. I love brains.
You do want to talk about brains?
Yeah.
Yeah, brains are...
We can get there.
Okay, so...
So that's helpful. Do you want to maybe... Yeah. What would be helpful for me is maybe understanding when you say that... I obviously have, like, some idea from watching your channel, but when you say that feminists do more harm than good in terms of advocating on behalf of and with trans folks, is there anything specific that you mean, or is it just kind of like a big amorphous blob of things?
It's a lot of things. The first thing that comes to my mind is it's very common within feminist spheres to argue that there is a lack of differences between males and females neurologically, and mm-hmm. that you know, gender is entirely socially constructed. And mm-hmm. really what that reduces transgender people down to is that they just become performers of gender rather right. than behaving in a way that their biology and neurology is fueling them to behave, which is what I believe. And, you know, I have a lot of sources to back that up, that it's not just one day you wake up and you're like, I want to be this. It's more of a, you know, you're biologically fueled to feel that way.
Mm-hmm. So that's interesting, because I feel like sometimes people feel the opposite way, as if to say that, you know, the social construction view of gender is actually more accepting of the existence of trans people and just, you know, a more broad idea of gender in general. Because if you say someone's brain or their gender is comes down to their sex or their brain, right, then it's sort of like, well, you are just your sex. You know, you are just, if you are born male, then you are male, and that doesn't change, and there's nothing different about it, right? So one of the things that I was confused about is, you know, you obviously see this through a different lens, and I'm trying to reconcile those two perspectives on gender, and my own view of gender is actually different than both of those. And maybe my view can reconcile those, but I'm just curious if you feel like there's like, are those people who see it as a construct, as a way of validating their identity, missing something?
I definitely think they're missing something. I think that what you said about how believing that it's a construct actually supports the idea of people, you know, living as different genders because of what you said, I actually think that it goes against it, because mm-hmm. you can allow that there are anomalies within that, that there are male and female brains, and that there are anomalies within that, that people can be born with. For instance, trans women are born with white matter levels similar to that of cis women. Mm-hmm. And that's one reason that scientists argue that they feel transgender, or they feel as if they should live as a woman. So a lot of times in the conversation of gender is socially constructed, those things are left out entirely. For instance, right. you had done a video talking about, I think you had specifically stated that there were no differences between male and females neurologically and in the brain.
I may have said that. I've been making videos for 10 years, but I actually don't subscribe to that view anymore yeah. because it's factually wrong.
Okay. Well, that's good, because I was going to, you know, kind of going on that a little bit, not yeah. in a harsh way, but just, yeah.
Well, so, you know, the conversation about brain differences is really interesting, because it is really nuanced, and we actually don't fully understand it yet, but there are some things that we do understand, right? And as you stated, males and females, and I kind of actually just as a, not for you, but necessarily, but for in general, the distinction between sex and gender right now, we're not necessarily talking about gender identity. We're talking about brains in terms of how they are sexed at birth. That's male, female, right? Those are the two main sexes. The vast majority of people fall in those, roughly those categories. And there is nuance in between, right? So I'm gonna speak in generalizations here, fully acknowledging that there is some variation across sex. But like you said, you know, there is more white matter in female brains. There's more gray matter in male brains. Another male difference is that men have larger amygdalas in adulthood, which is related to emotions and emotional processing. That doesn't necessarily mean they have more emotions either. Like the, yeah. you know, the relationship is very complicated, but I want to validate your perspective that being trans or like gender stuff is not just a performance, and it's not just a thing that we do in society. Some feminist theorists feel that way. I do not. I think that there are, like when you go way back, you know, to agrarian societies, you know, agricultural societies, there's maybe some sort of biological root biological root of our gender roles that we see today, right? But our gender and our gender identities, I don't feel like there is a biological destiny that comes from it, because our environment heavily shapes our brains. You know, like our brains are not just these static things that are just there and they don't change, and how you're born is how it will always be. That's absolutely not true. It's actually really amazing. Like, brains change every day. They change functionally, they change structurally. And when we're born, you know, infants generally have, minus like a small size difference, about a 10% size difference. Males and females have roughly the same sort of same looking brains in their in MRI scans. But as we get older, our brains do look different. Our brains are different in terms of some of the structures, the gray matter, the white matter, things like that. And that's really interesting in terms of what it means for gender.
Yeah, I guess then my point of contention would be with feminists, with how much they downplay how much biology actually fuels our behavior. For instance, in the cerebellum, men have more connections between hemispheres, which gives them more of an ability to act upon threats, and they're more in tuned with turning a perceived threat into action. And it's that kind of a thing. Women have more connections across the frontal lobe, which contributes to kind of a nurturing being and taking care of children, that type of thing.
Communication.
And what's interesting for me is that, and what's interesting for me is that as a trans person, having gone from one set of hormones to the other, you know, when I was born and throughout most of my life, my body was dominated by testosterone, is now dominated by estrogen, is that mentally you go through more of a change than the body, which there are big changes when you transition. You go through a huge mental change. And so that's really shaped how I view feminism and gender relations as well. The fact that my entire life, I never wanted children, then all of a sudden I'm on estrogen. And a few months later, I'm like crying, looking at videos of baby monkeys and their mothers. Like, I guess I address my point of contention, like I said, is how much feminists tend to downplay it. And unlike yourself, you're saying that you don't necessarily subscribe to that. I think a lot do.
Well, so I want to capture the nuance here, because I'm not saying that gender is biological, because gender is social. Gender, like by definition in like psychology, refers to the social meaning that we ascribe to sex, right? It refers to how we make sense of sex, how we see people's bodies and what we think that means. That's what gender is. And it has many different elements, right? It has our gender identities, it has our gender expression, and it has our gender roles, which are, you know, sort of set forth by our environment. And I want to acknowledge that some of the gender roles, like, you know, this idea that men should be physically stronger, like males are on average larger, you know? And so those things, I think there's a legitimate like place in terms of our sex. The relationship between sex and gender is real, but it's complicated. It's not just like your sex is your gender, which is a little bit kind of the direction that you're talking about. And it's not just like your gender is completely removed from your sex. I think that that's inaccurate as well. Now you're saying, you know, feminists tend to overemphasize the social element of it, right? And I think that comes from the fact that it is actually, gender itself is mostly social. Like if we could quantify it, and you know, neurologists, biologists, psychologists have tried to quantify it, they can't. You know, it is mostly social, how we interpret our gender in the world. But that does not mean that it doesn't have any sort of grounding in sex and in our experience of our bodies. So I think that there's sort of this argument, right? That gender is biological, women's brains are smaller, women are less smart, we can't do math, we are just emotional, nurturing baby makers. You know, this argument, these are the arguments that have stemmed from biological essentialism, this idea that it's only biological and that's it. And that's been very harmful to women, and it's also inaccurate. So when you see women pushing back against that strongly, and you see the feminist rhetoric pushing back against that strongly, that comes from, you know, a response to a really oppressive idea that, you know, I am just a uterus and I am, you know, I can't do math and my stupid lady feelings are everywhere, you know, things like that. So there's a reason for it. And I think the real nuance here is figuring out, you know, what the how what behaviors are influenced by biology versus sociology versus socialization. And we're still figuring that out. There are not scientific answers to all those questions yet.
Yeah, the way I tend to view it is that you said the way you view it is that you see it, if you could quantify it, that it would be more social than biological. My feelings are definitely the opposite. I think it's more biological than social. I think what is socially constructed often are the expectations of gender rather than gender itself. Mm-hmm. When I think of gender, I think of not just physiology, but also a set of behaviors, because men and women, on average, anomalies to the side, do behave in, you know, distinct ways. Mm-hmm. And we view that throughout, you know.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
We view that throughout all societies, throughout all time, even societies, you know, in the beginning that were completely isolated from each other. You see women and men taking generally the same gender roles, you know. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's a generalization, but yeah. In general.
Yes.
Yes. My question for you, sorry, I keep cutting you off. I'm an asshole. Continue.
No, I was going to say, but it's true, because like there's never been, you know, any society in the world in which the gender roles are swapped. And if gender was all or even mostly socially constructed, I feel like you would see at least one society throughout civilization in which women were, you know, in the roles of men traditionally. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. There are actually, I mean, it's like, it's not a common thing, right? But there is actually a few societies in Indonesia where that is the case. And what we would describe as a more like masculine role is what females are expected to take on. They also have more genders. Like their meaning that they ascribe to sex is a little bit more of a spectrum than we are here. We're just kind of like genitals, gender, right? And you know, in those societies, they just, that's not their tradition. That's not how they see it. So there are examples of that. I think it's slightly inaccurate to say that's never happened. It has, but you're right that it's rare. I think that the idea that, you know, behaviors are mostly biological is a little bit of a tenuous claim, just because we have so much research about how people's behavior is shaped. And we have so much research about not just gender, right? But like all kinds of things. We are like have figured out how to manipulate people's behavior, how to manipulate their emotions. And we can do that in social settings. And it's actually pretty like fucked up and scary, but that's a real thing. And like the implications for that in terms of the behavioral characteristics we ascribe to gender are real. And there are lots of ways that we're socialized. It's not just like, I am in this environment, therefore I am now this, right? It is actually a relatively complex process, socialization.
Yeah, I think we're just gonna keep going back and forth between, you think it's more social, I think it's more biological. I don't really know how much we could even keep harping on that, to be honest.
So do you think that gender is social at all? Like, to what extent do you think is it socialized?
I mean, you think of things like fashion, there's nothing in your biology that's like, girls wear pink, boys wear blue, that's not a thing. You know what I mean? That's entirely mm-hmm. social. But again, I think anytime you really talk about that, it's the expectations of gender that are socially constructed. I don't think necessarily, you know, there are certain small behaviors that are socially constructed, such as men open the door for women, et cetera. But there's even an argument to be made that goes back to men protecting women and ensuring the bloodline. You know what I mean? So mm-hmm. I feel like you can always go back and forth on that and say, well, is that social or is that biological? Has it always happened or has it happened then? So.
Sure. I totally hear you. I think that where we are disagreeing here is the role that socialization plays in shaping people's brains and like how we perceive biology. Because we have very good research, lots of it, about the plasticity of the brain that shows that, you know, people are socialized as women. They don't start out with strong communication centers in the brain. You know, they don't start out with those strong neural networks. There are a few things that we do start out with, which are motor function differences in aggression, things like that. There's like three or four things. But on the whole, the behaviors that we see they do not feed into each other. So it's hard, it is actually hard to kind of separate the two. So even arguing that like it's this much socialization, it's this much biology, is actually kind of not even really what we know to be going on in people's brains anyway. But I think for me, like in terms of understanding your argument about it being gender is biological, like the harm in that is when we start seeing people's sex as a sort of fixed, static destiny, and that, you know, it's a very narrow-minded way of seeing people and sort of the diversity of people, right? Like, you are born this, therefore you are this, and you are born that, and therefore you are that. Do you think that's a problem?
Well, the way I view it is, you know, I don't believe in absolute biological destiny in the sense that because I was born male, I will feel male forever. Clearly not. But in terms of, but the way I view, in terms of how, you know, being trans comes into this, I do think that if someone's born male, they're male and they will die male. I think that we just happen to live in a society in which certain people who are born male and who identify a different way, we afford them a certain amount of kindness and we will refer to them in a way and treat them in a way rather than you're born a sex and you can change your sex. I think that is kind of, it's fixed.
You sex understand? Is fixed.
Yeah. I mean, listen, there, we talked about how we wanted to discuss the number of genders. I say two. I say two with
anomalies. I say 9,000 genders. Let's talk about
it. I'm sorry.
Tell me what you mean by that.
Yeah. I mean, there are two genders and some people view intersex as being somewhat of the two or a third. In my eyes, and it's more of a birth deformity, I have a hard time classifying it as something else.
A deformity?
How do you feel?
Like in a derogatory way? Because I mean, it just is, right? It's not like.
I mean, the word deformity is only a derogatory if you know, want it to be. For instance, people say that being transgender is a mental disability or a mental illness, and people look at that and say, "Well, how can you hate trans people?" And it's like, well, technically, like, you know, gender dysphoria is absolutely a mental disorder. And it's only derogatory if you give it that, you know what I mean? Like, certainly some people will use it that way, but.
Fair enough. I would say that the word that I would use is more of an anomaly, I guess, because I do ascribe kind of a negative connotation to deformity, but that, like you said, it's just kind of how I see it. So this is where I think it's interesting in terms of how you see gender. How do you define, do you have like a definition that you subscribe to what gender is?
Yeah, I mean, I just go by the dictionary definition, which is the state of being male or female, typically in reference to social rather than biological. That's just,
right. So it's like the social aspects of being male or female.
Yeah, right. but it's also, there's the caveat, typically used to describe it this way, which means it doesn't have to be only talking about social aspects.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, there's always the conversation about like how, what dictionary, whatever. I respect that the like commoner's dictionary says that in the fields of like psychology and public health, which is where I study, you know, that is kind of the definition of gender, but not entirely accurate. It's more focused on the meaning and the meaning that people ascribe to sex. So there's the three elements, there's the gender identity, there's the roles, which you've talked about and which that definition explicitly references, right? The social being of male and female, and then there's the expression element of it. So in a more academic setting, people kind of break it down more into smaller parts, which is really necessary to kind of understand and know what we're talking about and get on the same page about some of the finer points of these issues. But you know, so if you are defining gender as sex, which I think that definition does more explicitly, then of course there's no room for more than two genders or more than three genders, really, because intersex is a pretty solid like third sex, and as an umbrella of lots of different sex conditions. So, you know, under that definition, would you say there are three sexes or three genders? Pardon me.
No, I wouldn't. I still see intersex as diversity for me. I mean, if you're born with male chromosomes and a uterus, that's a deformity. That's not, I don't see it as being, you know, a third gender, especially because, you know, obviously intersex people themselves, I've watched a bunch of documentaries about intersex people, and they typically, because they have that going on, that imbalance, or sometimes are born with, you know, like I said, a uterus inside of them, they typically, as far as how they identify, will go, you know, either which way. Mm-hmm. But to my knowledge, the fact whether they have male chromosomes or female ones still means that they're either male or female.
So you go by chromosomes?
I mean, not always. I know that that there are like exceptions and there are, you know, chromosomal diseases and stuff like that. But, mm-hmm. you know, an exception doesn't disprove, you know, a generality. And generally,
no, it's not to discredit a generalization. It's just to say there's more to this story than this narrative offers, right? It doesn't account for everyone. So I'm just wondering where people who don't, under your perspective, which is different from my perspective on this, you know, what is gender if you're intersex?
For me, what is gender if you're intersex? If you are talking about gender identity, like I said, sometimes, you know, when you're born with that, you end up feeling sometimes even like both. But again, that doesn't make you both. There are feelings, and then there are actually how you're born, and how you're born is oftentimes, in the case of intersex people, just with, you know, a deformity. That's just kind mm-hmm. of how I view it.
So do you, as someone who is trans, do you see gender identity and gender roles as different?
Well, yeah, I mean, gender identity is how you feel. Gender roles is the role that you take. I mean, for instance, if you're trans and you're going from male to female, before you transition and before you actually fill the role, you may still have the identity.
Right. You know? And so, what is, just so I can make sure I'm understanding you right, what is the identity, what defines that? Is it just how someone feels or what?
I guess to put it simply, it's how you feel, but it's also, there are neurological aspects to it. As we talked about, trans women, there's been studies that show that they're born with white matter levels similar to that of biological women. So there's a lot of things at play that cause a person to feel like the opposite gender. Neurological. And then there's also the mental disorder of gender dysphoria, which does plague trans people from, as far as we know, extremely young.
So in your perspective, being trans is a matter of your brain is different. And
yeah, that's my perspective, and in the perspective of, I mean, the science is not completely out, unfortunately. You know, there are a number of great studies. I would like if there were more conclusive studies and larger studies, but what we do know,
studies are a little lacking in this entire area.
But I'm almost not mad at the fact that we're lacking in the area, because trans people make up such a small percent of the population. It's like, how can you expect, you know, a ton of attention on this issue? But what was the question that you asked me?
Not to derail there, but I'm just trying to understand how your perspective of gender squares with intersex. Because I feel like what you're talking about, it doesn't fully account for it. And that's not to say that what you're saying doesn't have merits. It's just that it's not complete. Like, that's not in a sex ed classroom. When I'm teaching people, I can't just be like, oh, there's two genders. And like, if you have intersex traits, go fuck yourself, figure it out for yourself, right? Like, what does that mean for gender?
I mean, that's not what I'm saying. That's not what I'm saying either, though. I mean, I don't think that
classifying something. So what is it? I'm confused.
I mean, it's a deformity, and saying that someone has a deformity or is born,
Their gender, though.
Huh?
Not their sex, their gender. Like, in terms of their identity, their roles, like, what does that mean for
their gender identity? Yeah, I mean, I don't think anything I've said still equates to, like, go fuck yourself. I think I've already...
Well, I'm just saying it doesn't exist, and, this paradigm has only two, and, like, you don't get to fit in this paradigm, you know? No, I don't mean, like, go fuck yourself, actually. I'm just saying it's, like, there's no like, clear explanation, and, like, as a sex nerd and someone who studies this stuff, we need to account for all of the things, because if we have a theory of gender, we have a theory of sex, and it doesn't accurately explain all of these facets and the incredible diversity of human beings. You know, intersex is a very small category, yeah, but it's still millions of people on the planet, and we have to account for that. And if we're not, there's a hole in the the theory, right?
No, I think it's accounted for. I don't think under, you know, my perception of intersex that they're not accounted for. I mean, I think that just because someone's born with a deformity doesn't mean that they shouldn't be able to, you know, a lot of times intersex people decide to transition because for obvious reasons, sometimes they're born in a way that, you know, it's a woman who has an extreme amount of facial hair or whatever. So they decided to just transition and it makes their life easier. And I think they should be afforded that. I'm not saying you don't exist, you know, you're not in the paradigm, you're not in this, just go away. It's not that.
Right. But what is their gender?
I would say that their gender is, you know, what they say it is once they transition. I mean, if you are intersex and you're born as a biological female and you have testicles, or you're born with sort of an extreme hormonal imbalance, a lot of times that's the case with these people, then, you know, you're going to operate through society as a man, and that's how people mm-hmm. are going to view you.
So if their gender is what they say it is, basically it's only what they say it is if it falls into man or woman, right? Because there's only two choices?
Well, yeah, because, I mean, you could say that you're, I mean, what would even be another word they could use to describe their gender? Would they just say intersex or would they say something else?
Intersex is sex, right? So, you know, that's what's interesting about it is that there is no like clear, in my book, there's no clear answer to this question. You know, there's no straightforward answer in that. And one of the things that's compelling to me about the theory of gender that is not... related to sex, but it's not so like blank, therefore blank, is the relationship's a little more complicated. That complication creates room for a lot of the different phenomena that we see in people's gender identity and in their sex as well.
Right. I mean, obviously there's a lot of nuance, but I think at the end of the day, intersex, male, female, transgender, at the end of the day, you're going to operate through the world as one or the other, like you just are.
As a woman or a man?
Yeah, you're gonna operate through the world as that. I mean, there are people who view themselves as something in between, but it doesn't necessarily make them something in between. You know what
so
I mean?
What, like, yeah, how I understand what you mean.
Make you that.
How you view yourself doesn't make you a gender, mean?
No, you can view yourself as something all you want. I mean, even to this day, I view myself and I operate through the world and my ID says female and everything, but I know what I am. Technically, I know what I am. I'm a male and I was born male, I'll die male. So that's kind of the meaning.
But isn't there like a little bit of a spectrum of maleness? Because,
well, there's a spectrum.
Sorry, I don't want to be like probing into your transition or whatever, but like people can be on a spectrum of maleness to femaleness, right? And that can be done with hormones or, you know, a number of different interventions.
You mean like surgically altering yourself to like have,
well, not necessarily, also like hormone replacement therapy, right? Move someone more toward a different sex.
I mean, through hormones, you can get certain secondary sex characteristics of the opposite sex, uh-huh. but does that move you a dial in between? I don't think that it does.
But it's a spectrum, right? Like you bump, maybe it's not like a dial, but you definitely like bump a little bit more toward femaleness when you take androgen blockers, for instance, or estrogen.
I mean, I think the problem here is that we're defining femaleness. We're just like conflating gender and sex and going back in between what we're talking about.
That's
I think
fair.
You're talking about gender
Let's define our terms then. Yeah, I hear you.
Okay.
So female is... In your perspective, female is what?
Female is sex. But I think that the word female can also be used for gender, and it obviously is. I mean, my ID says female. It doesn't say girl or woman. You know what I mean? So,
but it's not, well, yeah, I will totally agree with you that people use gender and sex interchangeably, and I think it's so fucking confusing. Like, it doesn't need to be that confusing for people. You know, I really do think that in a world where we have more in-depth conversations about this kind of stuff, it's pretty obvious that we shouldn't be using the term gender on people's, you know, about their body parts, we're not talking about gender.
I mean, it gets messy when you go into in-depth conversations for sure, but that's kind of why I see, you know, my perspective on this a little better because it's a lot more simple. I just see male, female, you have your sex, and if you're transgender, you, like I said, you're just your sex that you're born as, and you may or may not live in a society in which you are afforded the ability to physically resemble the opposite sex and live as, and maybe even change your gender legally, but it doesn't change what you actually are.
So you don't feel like you're actually a woman?
No, not technically. I think that socially, through medical science and through living in the West, I'm able to fill the role of one. And perhaps the word caricature has a negative connotation to people, but I think that when you're a transsexual and you're a male to female transsexual, your life is kind of as a caricature of
female. I don't see your life as a caricature. And I don't see, you just said, like, you know, the whole gender as a construct thing allows people to kind of see being trans as putting on a costume. And I kind of
because that's not to ignore the fact that your biology still fuels you in a certain way towards that. Like, I'll always grant that. It's, you don't wake up and say, I want to be this. But in terms of what you can do, I mean, let's just say I don't believe in the transracial thing at all. There's no science behind it. But if there were to be science behind it, and there was a biological reason why someone could feel that they are Black, they could go through every treatment in the world. They could go through, you know, changing their skin color through whatever methods. They could, you know, train their voices to a certain dialect. They could do whatever. They will always still be the sex, race they started out as. Mm-hmm. So in a way, in a way, they are living as caricatures. I don't think that necessarily means that your life is, you know, shitty or worthless or anything like that. But at the end of the day, I chose a life of, you know, assuming something rather than being it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it makes sense. I think that, like you said, I think that you're conflating gender and sex. Just because, you know, you're talking about how you could never be really, like, you can sort of go through your life as XYZ, but you can never actually be. And, like, what it means to actually be is a loaded question, right? But I think it would be helpful here to make the distinction between female and male and intersex and man, woman, and we could throw transgender in there as a variation, but still just man, woman. And, you know, if we want to talk about non-binary genders, you know, you can throw those on that list too.
But it's always going to get messy, though, because even with those terms, we're going to perceive them differently. For instance, I perceive intersex as, you know, a birth deformity rather than a third or fourth or fifth gender.
So, well, I'm not saying it's a third or fourth or fifth gender either. It's just a third sex. It's a third sex. It's not a gender. Yeah, so maybe I should clarify my terms. Confusing.
But here's an interesting question. If it's not a gender, I mean, you said it's not a gender, but if gender
is not a gender, it's a sex. It refers to body.
Okay, I'll grant that, and I agree with that. But if you're going to say that someone's gender is what they feel and how they identify, then couldn't that technically be intersex? Couldn't you technically say my gender is intersex? I identify as being intersex. I mean,
someone could say that. No doubt about it. Maybe someone on Tumblr has said that, even if they're not actually intersex, right? But right. At the end of the day, the term intersex means something. It refers to a specific, we're talking about body things. We're talking about chromosomes. We're talking about hormones. And that is what intersex means. It's not a gender. It's not an identity. It's not a gender role. And it's not a way of dressing.
That also goes to say that male and female is a sex, and you're referring to very specific things. You're referring to chromosomes, anatomy, and therefore, despite the fact that, like I said, we live in a society in which you can do what you want, a transsexual can never be the sex that they want to be.
So, okay, I think I actually understand what you're saying now. Yes. So when you say that a trans person can't be what they want to be, you know, if you're talking about being the opposite sex completely, like in every, on hormones, chromosomes, gonads, all those sorts of things, not scientifically possible right now. But secondary sex characteristics, absolutely. Socially, absolutely. So what I'm trying to kind of in on here is the idea that femaleness and maleness are female and male. Let's say, for the purpose of simplicity here, even though this is not accurate, all right, that these are fixed categories, right, with their general categories, with a general set of traits. And if you are male and you transition, you know, you move toward femaleness. And I think that that doesn't make, I think where feminists and like the trans activism argument is that, you know, we're looking at this spectrum and someone's identification with their femaleness, their female aspects of themselves, we can validate that, even though I would say we also have to be, this is a matter of physical facts about our bodies. So, you know, we need to talk about what sex is. We need to talk about male, female, intersex as these somewhat, they're not super fluid categories. They have some give with hormones, but they're not just like the big wishy-washy thing like gender. Because otherwise we get into situations where, you know, we have females and males have different health issues. We have different health needs. It's not a gender thing. It's a sex thing. You know, our the warning signs for cardiac arrests are different. Our risk for osteoporosis are different. You know, females and males and intersex to an extent that I don't fully understand, to be quite frank, those sex characteristics affect our bodies and our experience of the world. But the gender aspect of it, you know, sex can inform our experience of gender, as you have spoken to many times. Sex can, our biology can inform our experience of gender. Our psychology can inform our how we see ourselves and how we move through the world. Our gender expression is just like whatever the fuck you want to wear. Like you said, socially constructed, right? Like paint your nails, do your makeup, whatever the fuck, you know, like it doesn't matter. That's how part of how people see gender though. And then the last element is the roles, which are, you know, kind of how we expect people to behave based on what we see their sex as. Not even necessarily what their sex really is, but I see you have boobies and therefore I expect you to behave and, you know, behave in this particular way or do these particular things or talk like this. Does that kind of make sense? Because maybe?
No, it absolutely does. It makes sense.
Okay.
I just think the problem here is that when you have such fundamental different views on gender and sex, we both have, it just makes the conversation so messy. I've had this conversation with another person on my channel and a million people online, and the subtle differences in the ways that we perceive them makes the conversation just so messy, and it makes
really
it
messy. I'll give you that.
You can never really come to like an end to the conversation, in my opinion. It just always.
I disagree with you there. I do think there is an end to this conversation. I think it's a matter of being able to actually, these are tough things to talk about, you know, and we don't actually have like a really strong language, like agreed upon terms and definitions, you know, things like that. So that makes it hard to talk about, like you said. But I actually think this conversation could be made much easier in terms of articulating what you are saying. And the things that you're saying that are true and the things that I'm saying that are kind of adding more to what you're saying by recognizing the difference between gender and sex, by recognizing the difference between our hardware and our software, by understanding sort of how our, that the social meaning of our bodies is real and that that is kind of arbitrary and that means that it's social, right? And it changes depending on who is observing XYZ gender and what culture we're in and, you know, all this it's messy.
It gets messy when you try to talk about, well, how much can you actually remove the two, gender and sex?
Gender and sex? But life is complicated, you know, and science is complicated. It's not like, oh, here's like some basic, you know, these are really complex topics that people study their whole lives.
Yeah, and I'm fully here for agreeing that gender and sex are different. I just don't think that they're so far removable. And I think that the difference is you just think it's a little more removable and separate than I do. And I think they're way more interlocked. But do you want to move on? Because we've talked about this for the entire time. Do you want to move on to the other topics we wanted to hit? Because I know you're only free in 4.
Yeah, whatever you'd like to talk about.
Okay, so what we put down was, this whole time we've really just talked about brains. I think we could just talk about feminism in general, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay. So I kind of wrote down, have you watched my first video that I ever made, which is basically talking about why I'm not a feminist or no?
No, I actually tried to find it and I couldn't, but I didn't actually scroll back through your category or through your catalog. I just Googled
Okay.
it. Do you want to like kind of tell me how you feel?
Okay, yeah. So you and I have a lot of fundamental differences when it comes to how we view feminism. I think that what I get from your videos is that you perceive the world in a sort of way in which women are placed nearly by every metric as disadvantaged. And I think that through my experience of being trans and experiencing in many ways both sides of the coin, I think that my perception is the exact opposite. I know you did a video, I don't know if you remember, where you had like multiple trans men on your channel kind of talking about their experience with male privilege. And I have a lot of disagreements with the concept of male privilege as it's perpetuated by feminism. Do you remember that?
So I didn't produce that video. That was a video that I like did at work. So I am actually not as familiar with it as a video on my channel. But if there's something specific about it that you want to talk about, just let me know what that is.
Well, how much role did you have in the video? Because I guess because it was a Laci Green video,
It
but
wasn't.
through.
It was an MTV video.
Okay, well, I guess then my problem is just that like you introduced the video and it was like on your show, MTV Rawlets. And so I took all the views in it as yours, kind of in the same way that if like
You
I
shouldn't.
did a video for a
You
company.
people
Okay.
who the perspectives that they espoused, I can't remember. I could go back and watch it, but the perspectives that they espouse are their own perspectives. I support people sharing their perspectives. It doesn't necessarily mean that I'm going to fully agree with them, although I might. I'm not sure. I can't really remember. It was a while ago. Is there something in
Okay,
particular that comes to mind?
well, in general, the basis of the video was a bunch of trans men coming together to talk about how the world was easier on them when they came out as men. Do you believe that that is true through your lens, your feminist lens, or no?
No, I think that every single person is different. So, your experience is going to be different than their experience, it's going to be different than my experience. And there's no universal truth in terms of how people experience it. I think that there has to be room for everyone's experience to exist and be acknowledged as, hey, that's your, I respect that that's how you experience the world. And I'm not going to like minimize that or dismiss it. I'm going to acknowledge it and engage with it, but it may not necessarily be my view of the world.
Okay, so what I guess that's my problem with feminism in general is that there is one really perspective through feminism. I know there's different like little branches of feminism, like there's trans exclusionary radical feminists who typically,
Right.
demonize trans people and think that they're, gonna rape them and shit.
Yeah.
But in general, there really is just the view of women being placed in a certain role in society that is lower or lesser than males. Do you find that to be true?
I think that that's an oversimplification, but in general, I do think
Well,
that
yeah.
feminine. Yeah. Okay. I do. My perspective on feminism is that we're looking closely at people's social, economic, and political experiences in the world. And feminism is the process of figuring out what those experiences are, first off, how, they fail people, regardless of gender. And then the activist element is pushing for things that we believe will help to make the playing field more peaceful, equitable, and approachable for everybody, so that people have equal access to opportunities and resources. Like have acknowledged, feminists really disagree on a lot of this stuff. This is not a like, here's the feminist argument. And I think that's one of the major sort of weaknesses of a lot of the feminist critiques on YouTube is that they fail to account for the fact that even like feminists would agree with some of the stuff they say. Like there's a huge range of how people think we should get to this point. We all want equality, we all want peace, we all want people to have their truth and their realities honored. But how we do that depends on who you ask,
Yeah, there are many branches of feminism. One of the things that I wanted to talk to you about was you've made a video that a lot of people found I guess, controversial. It was your rape accusations video. Mm-hmm. Do you remember doing that video?
Yes, that was on my channel and I wrote it.
Okay. So do you, have you swayed from your positions in that video at all? Or are you the same? Or
yeah.
Okay. Okay. So here's where we're going to find disagreement. Your kind of perspective, unless you want to say it yourself, what I got from the video, your perspective was that people who come out as saying they were raped or sexually assaulted or molested should be believed under any circumstance.
That's not what I said. That's not what I said. I didn't say under any circumstance. That's a pretty like broad claim. I take back the in any circumstance.
It was kind of implied when you said that if you come out saying that you're raped, I believe you. So that comes across as, you know, no matter what, I'll believe you.
It's not that no matter what, I'll believe you. It's that I default to not doubting people who have survived violent crimes. And I realize that they coming forward is a very difficult thing to do. And it's very loaded in terms of the consequences for people who come forward. And I recognize that the vast majority of cases, they're telling the truth. They're not coming forward to talk about this fucked up stuff for personal gain. That's such a bizarre assertion. And as someone who has worked with survivors, it's really damaging. Like, I don't think people who have, like, I don't know that people have fully engaged with how harmful this is, and you know, and the what it means to just assume that someone's lying about this off the bat, and to kind of have this trial of someone who has had their body violated in an extremely
violent ways. Yeah, I think that it's definitely harmful if you're really a victim to have anyone who right off the bat says this didn't happen to you. However, I don't think that's really as common of a thing as it is. I think that your perspective on it, which is kind of the believe perspective, is much more common. I think that, you know, I've seen this even in my own life, and you see it way too often in the news, is men get their lives ruined because of that, you know, believe thing. Mm-hmm. People automatically believe it and say, well, why would she lie about it? And, you know, I think that what we're missing here is that I've seen an FBI statistic, I think you cited in your video, which is that only 2% of rape accusations come out as being false. That number has been highly disputed, and among other sources, it's not something that's commonly looked into. The 2% number comes from, God, I gotta get her name, Susan someone, and she's a feminist activist. And where she pulled that number from, and where the FBI pulls that number from, was a speech that she did. And she was talking about one isolated area in New York in which the police department switched up their ways of investigating rape. And what they found in that very small part of New York was that 2%
of them. No, that's it. That's inaccurate. That's something you can just look up online. It's like blatantly, you know, the Department of Justice, the Bureau of Statistics releases this report every year. The FBI goes based off of their reporting, and you know, there's statistics for every single year, and it's fairly stable. This is not just a cherry picked number. And it's not certainly not cherry picked. The FBI is certainly not cherry picking from some random person's speech. You know, this is based on real data. And I can't, like, you know, either you acknowledge that or you don't, but that's a fact.
No, I can acknowledge it. I'm just saying I've looked into it, and the data where they pulled it was from an isolated area in New York. And so how comfortable you can be
the Bureau of Statistics reports are not based on small isolated areas. They're based on aggregated data from federal reports, which is nationwide. So, you know, you can just say, okay, like Blaire, let me say this, like this is, you can go Google this. It's not like a,
not like a
theory or a philosophy. It's just, that's just how it's done. You know, that's just the way that reports happen.
No, what I'm saying is that I did look into this, and that was where I saw the data came from, and we can compare sources afterwards. Obviously,
I'm happy to send it to you because I would like to see like what you're looking at as well, because that's false. You know, that's fake news. but okay, the, well, but you we'll, know, we'll even if it wasn't, But, well, I'll entertain the idea that it's not for a moment. And, you know, even if it's not, how have, you know, I'm just curious to hear about instances where people, you know, this phenomenon of people having their lives ruined by false accusations. Because from my perspective, I see a lot of people who have been accused and actually convicted of crimes who then go on to have very successful careers and to have, you know, they're completely, you know, there was this case of this, I think it was a Brazilian soccer player who literally had his wife murdered, eaten by dogs, and then was bought by another team. Like, this is real stuff that happens, you know, and it's like,
I think when it comes to celebrities or sports figures, there's definitely something sick there that people can overlook certain things like that. I don't think that would be fair to attribute to like society as a whole, that society just overlooks it and just automatically forgives debts. I don't think so.
I mean, there's no like universal way to paint all these really nuanced case by case situations. But my experience, and this is my job, right? I work hands-on in sexual violence with male and female survivors all the time. You know, this is, your perception of this is being skewed by the internet. It's not nearly as widespread or detrimental. And I think that this is a paranoia that people have. And look, I understand. I get it. And I think that where there are cases of
what's a paranoia? I don't understand what you said. What's a paranoia like that I'm talking
about? This idea that everyone, like, that, you know, survivors of sexual violence are out to get someone or something. Like, it's this grand conspiracy.
I'm not saying
you are, but this is what I've seen online, right? Like, this, and what I've heard in talking about this stuff online. Like, it's this grand conspiracy from women to just ruin a man's life or whatever. I think that is, there's more to that story and there's more to why people feel that way. But it's just not supported by the data. And I'm just kind of a science girl, you know, like if there's no data, I can't like level with that argument.
But I'm not making the argument. Like, I never said that women are out to like ruin men's lives. I'm saying that in instances where a rape accusation is made, true or false, the man's life is always ruined. It's just,
I don't think that's true. Like, I've worked on a lot of cases, like literally over 1,000 cases, all right, in my life, and then the last 10 years. And my experience is that, yes, you're right, that sometimes people who are convicted pay consequences, as they should. Sometimes there is a more nuanced situation where it's a little bit hard to tell what's going on. And do people suffer? Yes, I'd say that both parties, or sometimes that's actually usually more than two parties involved, all of those parties suffer. But I just don't think that this is the problem when it comes to sexual assault in our country. Like, I don't think this is our issue, you know?
I'm not saying it's the problem. I'm not saying that the only conversation there is to be had about rape is how false rape accusations are made. Obviously not. You know, mm-hmm. I'm not even here to argue that most accusations are false, because obviously.
Okay. Well, I appreciate that.
That just wouldn't make sense. But I will say that the number one crime for which the Innocent Project releases people from prison because they were put there unjustly is rape. So I think there's something to be said about that.
Maybe. I'm not familiar with the, actually, I actually, the Innocence Project, they like, they investigate it.
They investigate crimes and they try to release people who are wrongly accused and wrongly thrown away.
Yeah, I think I heard about them through the Serial podcast. But, you know, that may be the case. I don't think that necessarily makes any particular point. I think that the conversation about rape and sexual assault, particularly in a legal context, is very complicated. And, you know, we're talking about crimes that occur behind,
It's difficult to prove as well.
It's difficult to prove. And, you know, it's difficult to prove sometimes, even in cases where people have gone to get rape kits done and have physical evidence They don't always get tested by the police department. Police departments actively kind of don't pay attention to this stuff, don't take it seriously. And that's a problem. You know, I just think that there's a lot more to this story about, you know, sexual assault survivors and the idea that rape is often, or even like, or that this is like a very significant problem that warrants our constant conversation, because it is a constant conversation, much more than we talk about, say, male sexual assault survivors, because men are way more likely to be sexually assaulted than they are to be falsely accused. And being sexually assaulted can ruin someone's life. Right. Absolutely. So it's the same sort of.
But what I'll say is that personally, I've talked way more about men and them being in positions of, you know, being victimized through sexual assault than I have false rape accusations.
I appreciate that, because I think a lot of people don't talk about it enough. And it's very stigmatizing, you know, for men who are violated to feel like they can't talk about it. And that's something that we really got to work on. It's something that I work on. I talk about it every time I give a talk or every time I, you know, work with an organization about sexual assault. We have men in the conversation as well.
That's great. It just so happens that looking through your library of work, that was a video that I took issue with, because again, I don't like coming from it from a position of someone makes an accusation and we believe it. I think that's dangerous.
It's not really about believing an accusation. It's about acknowledging the context in which someone comes forward with a story about having the inside of their body violated, and you don't just say, "Why are you lying?" You know, it's like,
you don't have to go on.
I will listen to your story and I will support you in any way that you need, and I will believe you, because I know that society tends toward not believing you. And there are a lot of reasons why we don't. I've actually studied this pretty extensively, why people don't believe survivors who come forward. You know, like, I think one of the more interesting cases recently was the Amber Heard situation. It wasn't sexual assault, but with domestic violence, and how people say she's lying and she's a gold digger. She posts a fucking video of it. She wins a $7 million settlement and donates it to charity, and people still accuse her of lying. Like, I think if we want to talk about things that we should scratch our head at, we should definitely be scratching our head at that too, with as much or more vigor, because it happens more often.
No, but my point is criticizing irrational reactions to rape in general, because as much as you can point out how this woman offered proof and she was still never believed, there are people such as the mattress girl who comes out, and it comes out that she wasn't raped at all. And people to this day,
Sorry, I'm not familiar with the mattress girl, but I have heard of false rape accusation stories, of course, because it's not like that doesn't ever happen. It does.
It does happen. And my point is that when it does happen, these men or these boys' lives are destroyed, essentially. I mean, they go through the entire process. Sometimes they drag it on forever before they actually, you know, prove innocence. And it becomes, you know, this person can't get a normal job. This person oftentimes is all over headlines as a rapist. Their families abandon them. Like, I don't think that it's as easy as saying that. I think there's a difference between supporting people who come out and believing them. I don't think you should automatically believe someone in the same way that you shouldn't automatically believe someone who comes out and says, this person, you know, killed my family member. You have to look into it, because you can't just automatically decide there and there that they're telling the truth.
Sure. You know, in general, I fully agree with you. In another context, I'd fully agree with you. I think that because I'm considering myself a skeptic, you know, I'm an atheist. I don't take like statements at their face value. All right. But I think that in the case of sexual assault, I think that the dynamics are different than like making claims about, you know, climate change or Christianity or whatever. I think it's very different. And the circumstances in which someone comes forward to talk about that are very different, for better or for worse. Like, you know, it's just has much more complexity than a lot of the conversations that we have, and approaching it as like, if you're a skeptic, you know, and you question everything, approaching it with that mentality can be very destructive, in terms of making people feel like they can talk about it, because it's already so, there's so much shame, you know, there's so much shame and embarrassment about it. Huh?
I don't think questioning it is destructive. I think questioning it is being in the middle. Believing it is too far, and condemning it automatically without looking into it is destructive. I don't think that questioning it is destructive at all.
If I sat in a room with a survivor and said, are you sure that happened? That's destructive. And if I'm a friend, if my friend comes forward to me and tells me something that happened and I say, are you sure? Like this, that doesn't sound like something they do.
That's a different type of setting. What I'm talking about is, you know, if online. Someone's coming, not just online, but if someone's coming to you as a friend and they're crying and they're saying, this happened to me last night, obviously it's your friend. You're going to say, oh my God, that's horrible. You're going to believe them.
But what context are you referring to then? I mean, okay. Those are the first contexts I think of. And those are the contexts that a lot of survivors talk about having the experience of first being doubted by like friends and family. It's not necessarily like being aired out to the internet. So are you talking about like the media? Are you talking about like high profile situations?
I'm definitely talking about the media, and I'm talking about, for instance, in your video, the guy, Sam Pepper, mm-hmm. I believe those accusations against Sam Pepper came from, was it Sam Pepper or someone else? Someone else you used like in the thumbnail. Was that the one in the thumbnail? Do you remember?
I have talked about Sam Pepper had a lawsuit against him. Yeah. And I talked about that. I also talked about Toby Turner. I don't think I've talked about it.
It was whichever one in which the accusations solely came from Tumblr. It was literally a Tumblr post accusing.
Neither came from Tumblr. Both were actually court cases. They were reported to the police. Both of those cases had actual legal fallout. And actually some of them are still in process.
I think there was one person, you might have flashed their picture when you were talking about people being accused, and it was someone who there was no legal fallout.
That's possible. I'm not sure who you're talking about though.
Yeah, but see, that would be, you know, the problematic part when in the conversation of people accused, it becomes this person's face plastered among the word sexual assault. And then it gets
into. I would never accuse someone if I didn't have pretty solid evidence though.
No, I'm not saying you accuse them.
Yeah. I'm pretty careful about that stuff because, you know, I think this, getting this right really matters. It's like a very high stakes situation. It's not like, you know, let's go frolic in the fields and talk about our theories of gender. This is a really, when we're talking about like the legal system and legal consequences, this is a serious, I didn't mean to say that like to sound like gender is not serious. It is, but you know, sexual assault, the immediate legal impact is very serious.
No, absolutely. So I don't know,
Blaire,
how much I can do
on my
point.
I hear you. I guess what I would ask of you is, you know, will you treat survivors with dignity and respect? For people,
I mean,
who are worried about sexual assault.
I treat everyone with dignity and respect. And if someone came to me in a state of upset and was telling me something that happened to them, I'm not going to go into some, you know, questionnaire form and be like, well, did he do this? Or were you, you know, it's not like that.
Okay. That's reassuring.
But in terms of having, you know, big conversations about a particular incident removed from the emotion of this just happened to me, I think that it's dangerous to automatically go to, and I believe them.
So in the big context though, you know, that's not removed from emotions. Like it's still just as consequential. In fact, sometimes more consequential because the person's dealing with like a public fallout now, you know, like with all the Cosby stuff, like.
But that's what's dangerous about saying, and I believe them, because then it becomes an automatic condemnation of the person who, the other person who's involved, the person who may or may not have done it.
And if you say, I don't believe you, which is implied when you question, when you seem to question their character or imply that they're lying, that's also very damaging, right?
But I've already agreed that. I don't say that either. I don't say automatically, oh, I don't believe you or I believe you. I say, wow, we need, you know, this needs to be looked into. And should go to court, and there should be rape.
Well, of course, for a legal case, it needs to be looked into. But look, the vast majority of these cases don't actually have any sort of legal fallout. They don't have any legal ramifications. We're just talking about people's experiences, and we're talking about people's experience with their sexuality, with their bodies, with relationships, and with being violated. So it's not necessarily that it's like we need to have a detective get in here, because that's the vast majority of the time, that's not how it goes down. You know, we're just talking about supporting people who are experiencing, have experienced sexual violence. And I think it's maybe more nuanced. Like, my experience is that it's more nuanced than what you're talking about. And maybe it's just because, you know, your experience with it is mediated through the media.
Well, not even just that. I mean, there have been more than one person in my real life in which sexual assault accusations have been thrown at them. And the fallout for the person accused is just huge. And it comes out later that it was true, or it was a revenge over a relationship, or it was someone trying to fuck over someone's life. And that's why I'm so weary about this listen and believe policy in which someone comes forward and says this happened, and we automatically say, okay, I believe you. Because you're not just saying, I believe you. You're saying, I believe you that this person did this, and this person's a horrible person who violated you in this way.
It's not, I think you're maybe assigning too much, like, you're I don't see it that way. Like, I think that in a legal case, like, let the law do whatever. But, you know, when I say I believe you, it says, I'm saying, I know you're not lying to me right now. And I know that what you're saying is legitimate and real. And there is very, I acknowledge the context in which there's very little, usually there's very little incentive for someone to argue about it. And when you're talking about that, can be really damaging if someone lies. You know, I think I feel, because I see that this is the real damage in my experience. The real damage comes when people have this dismissive attitude toward people. And that is actually the root of, you know, we're talking about, I heard this analogy, I think it was on Bill Maher. You know, we're talking about something that's relatively small and real, all right? There's a small fire raging, and this is a fire that we need to put out and we need to address, but there's also a fucking wildfire behind us, you know? And so to me, when we're talking about the harm that's experienced, like the proportional, like, focus on these issues, there's a preoccupation with this small fire, and we should put out all the fires, but let's not forget that there's a wildfire behind us. You know, like, that is a big, a huge problem in society. And yeah, so many more people are sympathetic to the perspective that you're espousing than are sympathetic to the perspective that I'm espousing in my work.
I don't think so. Maybe we come from different worlds. I heard we both came from Northern California.
I live in this world. I work in this world. This is my life. And I'm telling you, like, I don't doubt your intentions. I don't doubt that you're telling the truth. I'm telling you, like, girl, there's more to this. I do. I really do. I'm just saying there's more to this story, and, like, don't get carried away. Don't get carried away on it, you know, because it can be dangerous. What you're saying is valid, but in proportional response, right? Proportional response.
No, there's more to the story, but I would argue that my response is actually proportionate, because, I mean, you say that there's a preoccupation with the small campfire and not with the wildfire, but I don't think that that's true. I think that there is an extremely limited amount of resources for people, you know, to move on after they're falsely accused. I think the conversation really doesn't happen as often as you think that it does, or that you
believe. I'm not saying that it doesn't happen. That conversation you're talking about should be where we go, right? That should be what we're talking about when we talk about this stuff. But instead, it's like the conversation is like, should I or shouldn't I believe someone? When really it should be, let's have this, you know, approach where we acknowledge that sexual violence is a real problem and get out of this paradigm where we always think that it's not real, that people are lying or whatever, and address all of the problems. It doesn't have to be like your problems and your problems, like all of these things can be addressed at once. And you're right that there's not enough focus on things like that, and that that's an important conversation, but that's not how it's usually framed when people bring it to me, you know? And so I look at that and I'm like, you're removed from the reality of this situation, and that's fine because this isn't everyone's reality, but it's mine. And, you know, I am very familiar with this world, and this conversation internationally as well. So, hey, let's talk more about that stuff. Let's also, like, not demonize survivors so much. It's so fucked up, you know? And it's really, I think if people could see, like, what it does to people, that's the harm is not seen, you know? And maybe in what you're talking about.
But is there really that many people who demonize survivors. I don't think that there is.
I disagree. I fully disagree. I'm not saying like all the time uniformly, just like all the time, everyone hates them and nobody believes them. I'm not saying that's how it is. There's nuance, right? But in general, you know, outside of the spheres of people who are pretty engaged in this conversation, I would say people tend to be like, I'm not sure, but particularly in certain situations, right? Where maybe the survivor is not like a sympathetic, perfect victim, right? Maybe they were drunk, or, you know, the whole, what were you wearing question, like things that make people doubt whether or not it was real or legitimate, things like that, those shape people's responses. And that's a real thing that happens. So let's talk about it. Let's talk about what you're talking about. You know, let's talk about all of it. Just not to, you know, my bottom line feeling on this is an incredible amount of concern for people who have had their bodies violated in really violent, terrible ways. And like, no, we have to be careful about that, because that happens far more often. It's far bigger of a problem. Our responses to it are not proportional or empathetic as they need to be. And I think that should change.
I agree with that. I think that society does take rape extremely seriously.
What experience do you have with this, though? Like, I've traveled the world talking about this stuff. Like, where is it? Just like you're talking about the media, a couple of friends?
No. I was a victim at 18.
Okay, that's fine. But like, you're talking about anecdotes.
No, you're not really letting me finish. When you look at, you go to prison for rape, sexual assault, touching your cousin when you're fucking 21 and they're 16. Okay, that's gross, but something as you range from that to like violently raping someone in an alleyway. You go to prison for that. I mean, even in prison systems, places where the people that go there, we typically see as, you know, having a low moral code. You know, murderers are in there, robbers are in there. Like, everyone hates rapists. If you're a rapist and you go to prison, you have to be put oftentimes in, you know, isolation, because they will beat the shit out of you. They will kill you if you are convicted of that and you go to prison. I mean, would you agree with that? I mean, that's a very common thing.
I feel like that's something that data can answer, not like a personal opinion or anecdote. So I'll, for the sake of this conversation, yeah, I'll go with what you're saying. But that isn't necessarily related to what the conversation about survivors.
No, it is, because if we talk about how people view rape and rape survivors, and if you, in your view, you know,
the broader society though, is it like a different group of people in prison? No, we're talking about a specific group of people.
But people are in prison at one time were a part of society, and we deem them to be the lowest of the low in terms of morality within society.
Yeah.
And for those people to even think that rape is horrible, I'm not sure how well that goes with your idea that, you know, victims are demonized and people don't believe victims, etc.
Well, I'm not, but you're saying two different things. Like, I'm not saying that people don't think rapists are horrible. Of course they do. Like, people acknowledge that rape is bad and scary and wrong, and they do not condone it.
So you think most people think that rapists are horrible people?
I think most people think rapists have either are horrible people or have made a terrible mistake. Yes.
Okay, so how does that fit in with you also believing that most people, or a lot of people, or it's very common within society, that victims are also demonized?
Because rape is seen as bad doesn't mean people believe someone when they talk about having experienced it. I think those are two different phenomena.
But then is not believing someone demonizing them at the same time? Because for me, I'm not going to automatically believe someone who says that they've been raped. I want evidence, I want proof, etc. Because again, when you say, again, you keep talking about how not believing them is destructive, but I'm not taking that position either. I'm taking skepticism in the middle. That's the only way to do it, in my opinion.
Right. Well, in the context that these things play out, I would say that being critical of someone's claims in this context of sexual assault is dismissive. I don't think it's the same as demonizing. I think demonizing is sort of a purposeful portrayal of someone as a particular like scary thing.
But how often does that happen, though? I mean, I can't think of
demonizing victims. You mean?
Yeah, I mean, I can't think of anything.
Sometimes, Amber Heard's a pretty good example of being demonized, right? She was like completely reamed by the media and like completely reamed by social media about this stuff, and she was demonized for mentioning. You know, we all loved for me Johnny Depp, and it's hard for people to hear that, and they demonize her instead because it's a hard sort of terrifying reality to grapple with, but she had so much evidence that she won her case that she was absolutely demonized, you know, and she was not believed either.
But then we're talking about the celebrity aspect as well, which I think is much different. I think that
it adds a layer, but I see some of these threads sort of like there's similarities across all these situations, whether it's like a high school, a college, a marital rape, or a celebrity thing. They all share similar dynamics and kind of have the similar, the conversation and the social fallout is not exactly the same, but there are strong similarities.
I'm not sure. I think the celebrity aspect adds more than just a layer. I think it comes into play. You think of Bill Cosby, you know, Bill Cosby, so much a part of culture, you know, beloved by so many people, it's going to be, of course, a lot more difficult for people to, you know, think that someone would have done that.
Absolutely. I definitely agree with you on that.
I think if you want to try to bring that down to everyday society, I think in terms of like someone's family, it's probably until the very end not going to believe the proposed victim, like the family of the accuser. But I think in general, the average person who opens up a newspaper and sees, you know, woman on Fifth Street raped by someone, they're not going to say, ah, she's probably lying and doing this. I think it's going to be, oh, wow, what a fucking dirtbag. We have perverts running our streets.
Yeah, I think the stranger scenario you just described, people tend to believe. Are much more sympathetic. They tend to not doubt the survivor as much when it's a stranger. But the vast majority of sexual assaults, 73% of them are not a stranger. And those are the situations where we see a different reaction. You're right. I do not disagree with you at all there. I think the context is different between a stranger attack and then acquaintance or someone that you know. And it makes sense, right? Like it makes perfect sense because if it's someone you know, and I think, you know, several of us have been in this position, and that's part of why this conversation is so hard. If it's someone you know, or it's like you said, a family member or something, that adds a layer of emotional complexity to this issue. And sometimes it's easier to just kind of tell yourself that they're lying about it, or we kind of have this knee-jerk reaction to doubt them and to question them because we don't want to believe that that could happen or that someone could do that. And that's a perfectly human. It's a human thing, right? It's human. And I understand where it comes from. I just think people got to be aware of it and sort of probe their feelings and their responses and reactions to these things and their assumptions about these things.
Yeah. I mean, I remember when I was in middle school, there was an instance in which a father was accused of molesting these two kids. I hope I'm okay to talk about this. Yeah, there's no way anyone could find these people. But there was an instance in which a father was accused of sexually molesting his two children. And in the entire town that I lived in, it was a relatively small town, everyone instantly was on the side of
the children. Absolutely, yes. Because they're children. So this is what, I'm glad you brought this up because it's kind of, I think the distinction.
Can I just say one thing about because you're talking about how society overall views, you know, the victims as lying or demonizes them or is not on their side. But then like every instance I'm bringing up of people believing the victims, you're like, oh yeah, well, you know, if it's children or if it's a stranger or if it's celebrity, it's like, so what?
Well, I don't think that these two things we're saying aren't compatible with each other because what you're describing are different contexts. And how we respond is different in different contexts. You're not describing the usual context of child molestation has a different, it's similar, but there are different sort of dynamics surrounding with it that I'm not as familiar with because I work with sexual assault, not as much with child abuse. But the distinction is this. There are people who are sympathetic victims and there are people who are not sympathetic victims. And my experience is that our response or our sort of knee-jerk willingness to agree or how we feel about it is shaped by how we see that person. If it's a child or someone who was attacked by a stranger or, you know, this horrific, you know, someone who was disabled and, you know, it was clearly like this horrific, overtly horrific, no like room for nuance, right? Then yes, I think people, you're right. Like people are, they tend to take the more just view and say, that's not okay. You know, this is morally wrong and we're not gonna condone this in our society. But I think the situations that have more nuance are the ones where it's like, people kind of see the survivor as not necessarily being like a real victim. Like, I'm not sure if you could really be this, if you're a lot, like maybe you have an incentive or, you know, the ones that I see all the time are you were really drunk or you dress a certain kind of way, things like that. You know what I'm saying? Does that make sense?
No, I know what you're saying. There are sympathetic victims and non-sympathetic ones, but even in those instances in which people take the moral choice of, oh, it's a kid saying, and or, oh, it's, you know, a person who was just jogging down a dark path and they instantly like, oh, we have to sympathize with that person. Again, I think that the listen and believe policy is dangerous because the story I was telling of those two kids accused, it was actually the dad did not do it. It was the mom and the dad going through a divorce and the mom was pitting the kid against the parents. Mm-hmm. And this man's life, it's fucked to this day in that town. The name is just like the name automatically has molester on it or abuser on it.
I know, so. And that's fucked up and that's horrible, right? There's like no, that's undisputably like fucked up that things like that happen. And you know, what I'm saying is not to diminish that or to erase those experiences. It's really not. I think that, you know, like I said before, that we should talk about that. But I think that it is hard when the conversation so often goes to that place first, when, like I said, proportional harm, not necessarily the intensity of the harm or the real the lived personal experience is equal. You know, like people, I'm not going to put a hierarchy of people's pain essentially, but proportionally, like statistically, in terms of what we're looking at, it rubs me the wrong way that it always goes to that. And I understand why it goes there. Like there's real psychological dynamics there. And I think there's room for both. I think there is absolutely room for both. And we should talk about both.
I guess the point we just disagree on is that it always or most of the time goes there. I don't see it the same way. I don't think most people go automatically towards victims.
And that's our experience, right? Like you and I just have different sort of interaction with this and that's okay. I think that we just kind of have to, both of us need to acknowledge, you know, I'm going to say to myself, you know, Blaire's experience of this issue and in this is she sees it the other way. Like there's a real problem there that's not being addressed in her circle, in her community. And we need to pay attention to that. You know, that's my takeaway.
But I don't think it's just my circle. I think in society, it's just not a conversation very often. And like I said, there are little to no resources for men who are falsely accused and have their lives ruined by a spiteful ex-girlfriend or a kid pitted against them by the mother or vice versa, women raped you. So I don't know, I guess I just have a problem with saying that it's just my experience or my community because yes, I've had experience with it in my community, but I think that that resonates throughout all of society. I don't think that there's a whole lot of conversations had about it.
Yeah, I respect that you feel that way. I just think that what you're saying is a question for data. It's not necessarily a question that you or I anecdotally can make claims on. You know, like that's something that we would need. And we have sort of looked at, you're right, that there aren't resources. There are some, there are a few. I've run into several actually, but they're kind of like niche little, I just happen to run into them because that's what I do. But yeah, I think that when it comes to claims about the big picture, I tend toward, we need data.
Yeah.
Because we can't really see the forest through the trees. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So this leads me to another point, and this is another reason why I've always had an issue with feminism, even before I transitioned and I was like done with feminism completely, was that there is a lack of visibility of men's issues within feminism and within most conversations about gender. How do you feel about, do you feel that same way? Because there are numbers like the male suicide rates, the fact that 75% yes. of homeless are men, which is yes. crazy to me. 75% of homeless, the rape rates are insane as well. Not rape rates, the suicide rates are insane as well. Mm-hmm. You look at a lot of rape statistics, it's often classified as a women's issue, even if, you know, the rates are like 60-40, in which case I don't think it's fair to say that it's like a women's issue. How do you feel about that?
I agree with you. I agree. I think that when it comes to gender equality, we should be looking at how these gender roles and constructs and our experience of gender shapes everyone's experience. And I think that, you know, the reason why we tend to focus on the female experience is because, you know, that's the sex that has traditionally had a lot of oppression based on their sex. And that's not to say that men are not oppressed. Absolutely not. I think that, you know, the very dynamics, and you're familiar with this, like you're college educated, you know, the very dynamics that sort of produce inequalities for women also produce inequalities for men. And we should talk about that. You know, I am very interested in the question of preventing male suicide, preventing suicide, period. But the question of what's at the heart of that, I've done a little bit of research on it. You know, stuff about the methods are different. This yes. is just like the darkest shit ever, like rape, suicide. Yay!
We're getting so, real, girl. We're talking about real topics.
I know. It's some real shit. But I'm very concerned about that. And I'm very concerned about the men in my life who experience these things. And my experience is, in my feminism, personally, I can't speak for everyone. And I don't know like how other people experience this. My experience is that we do talk about, in my spaces, we do talk about male issues. Because I talk about sexual assault and stuff, we talk about male sexual assault. And we don't necessarily talk about male-specific stuff. Like, it's not talked about, like, female for 50% and male, like, 50%. No, we talk about the general conversation about sexual assault, and then we talk about some of the unique barriers and challenges that come up for male survivors. So in my spaces, we are talking about these things.
So your conversations with, like, other activists you know in real life and stuff, that's when those issues come up, is what you're saying?
Oh, well, mostly
I would say that in your like YouTube videos and your work with MTV, I haven't really seen any men's stuff.
That's not true. I've made several videos on male issues. Well,
you've made some, but I guess it's just, I guess there's a little bit of contradiction when you say that you're highly interested in it and you talk about it in your own circles all the time, but the preoccupation seems to always be on women's issues.
Well, I talk about women's issues because I am a woman. And I often am informed, you know, I'm speaking to where what I do comes from my experience in the world, just like yours does. And I can't really speak to a male experience. And I know men that do. I know many wonderful male activists who are out there, and I'm friends with them. They're writing books. They speak at schools. So in my world, I don't see it that way. But
you don't need to like, live as a man and have male experiences to talk about male suicide or to talk about male homelessness being through the roof. Like,
of course, I teach sex ed. So when I talk about male stuff, I'm talking about domestic abuse toward men. I'm talking about sexual assault toward men. And I'm talking about circumcision. Go look on my channel. I have tons of videos about that stuff. Anything that's related to sex ed, I have talked about the male information for it.
Yeah.
There might be like one or two things. All right. Be like, you didn't talk about this. Okay. I haven't covered everything for females either, but I do talk about that stuff and it is on my channel and it's part of my work in real life, which is.
Yeah. But how do you feel about, I mean, you agreed with me earlier, right? That like it's barely visible in feminist activism most of the time, not saying your channel specifically, but in general, it's just not You know, I've seen other people use the same argument that they don't talk about it because they don't have male experiences or they're not men. But I've always kind of found that to be a little bit of a cop out, because I don't think you have to have male experiences to talk about it. Like if there was, if there was some, you know, instance, if female circumcision was suddenly coming to America, God forbid, I wouldn't say, well, I don't have a vagina, so I can't talk about it. Like, you know what I mean?
Well, yeah. And I've talked about it. Like I have talked about all of those things. So, you know, and when you talk about the broader community, like my impression is that, yeah, like everyone that I work with, every conference that I go to, that is there. Like we have at every conference, literally there's panels, and I don't feel like it's just, I don't feel like it, my lived experience in the world is the same as how it's portrayed or even talked about online. But you know, this is something that I don't know, like I'm just one person, you know, and I can't, I don't have like the spectacles gazing down on the world, you know. I don't know like what the, how to quantify it, but for me, I think those things are fucking important. And I think talking about male survivors and giving them space is fucking important. And we need to talk about domestic abuse and how those dynamics can play out. And yes, women are disproportionately on the receiving end of some of these sexual issues that come up when we talk about these things in the classroom. Absolutely, disproportionate. But that doesn't mean that those things can't apply to men, and it doesn't mean that we shouldn't talk about those things. That's my feeling on it. I can't speak for anyone else, you know?
No, and that's good. My issue was more of how you feel. I guess in your lived experiences, most feminists in your area do talk about it. Mine is the opposite. It's almost never a conversation. If you look at popular culture and feminism, you know, in popular culture, it really is never. I mean, can we agree on that? That it's like really, it's rarely talked about. I mean, if you don't specifically look up, you know, on a lot of these men's awareness websites, a lot of these numbers, like male homelessness, rape rates, suicide rates, you're just never going to hear about it. But you'll always hear about, you know, certain inequalities among women, certain stats from that arena. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I hear you. And just to add to that, to add to my agreement to you, I think that feminism in and of itself, I think I've heard you say you don't subscribe to this belief, but I really do. I do think that deconstructing kind of our view of gender and having a more open-minded, complex, you know, allowing ourselves to think in more complex terms does actually help with some of these issues. Like we can address gender issues as a whole by addressing them at the root. You know, a lot of these things, not everything, but a lot of these things, a lot of these fruits come from the same seed. And we need to sort of examine what that is and figure out how to approach that in a healthy way. And, you know, in the case of male suicide, this is a complicated topic. I'm not an expert on it, but I believe that from my experiences, as it's informed by my life, I see that the men in my life who really needed help feel like they don't have anywhere they can get help, feel like they don't need help, and feel like they have to deal with everything alone. And it's really hard to watch. It's really painful, you know? And I do see that as stemming from this fucked up expectation that men never be vulnerable. Like they never show weakness. They always have to be resilient. They always have to show emotional strength. And that, you know, having mental health issues means you're weak. That,
and also the expectation that men are always supposed to maintain their own comfort, financial stability.
Yes. Everything.
I mean, the fact that.
Yeah. It's a lot of, it's a high expectation.
Yeah. The fact that 75% of men are homeless. I mean, I've seen, you know, feminist articles talking about how poverty is, you know, a women's issue and how poverty is affecting women. And it's like, it's just frustrating to see it always, everything through this gynocentric lens when there are some issues that, you know,
affect everyone. Yeah. And
there's,
you know,
some issues that there's some issues that completely disproportionately affect men that are just never talked about. And I think it's fucked up. I think we agree on that, which I think is nice, because I think most people perhaps have this perception of you that you don't care about those issues. So I think that's...
I think that people who are familiar with my work don't think that at all because they follow my work and they know that I do talk about it and they worked with me at schools and stuff. But, you know, in terms of the conversation about this online and like feminists not talking about it, I agree with you that we should, I think there are reasons why it doesn't come up as much. And that's partially because, you know, women in the women's movement, they're talking about their experiences. And, you know, we shouldn't put anybody's experience in like a, in a hierarchy, but there are a lot of, there are a lot of really pressing, fucked up things that are happening to women too. And I don't think that that is, that talking about those things should be seen as like, therefore you are not X. So should we hold people accountable to talk to, about both? Yes, but I don't think it should be seen as bad or wrong for us to talk about one or the other in isolated contexts either.
No, I don't think that either. But I think when it comes to feminism, a lot of them love to throw out sort of the definition of it's just about equality between men and women, but then they only focus on one gender issue. Mm-hmm. And that's obviously contradictory. You can't label yourself as a gender activist for both genders and only focus on one thing, which is the case with most feminists. I'm not saying it's you, but it is the case with most that I see in most feminist works, literature, and everything. Everything seen through.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that's true to my experience, but I do see it. Like, it's that I do see. I agree with you that that's out there. But in my sort of crew, yeah, I don't see that quite as much. I think there is sort of almost like an increased sensitivity around men's issues because we're often women that are talking about men's issues.
Yeah, well, you probably hang out with people who feel the same way about you, so you're gonna meet people who care about both. But
yeah, and you know, I don't think it's necessarily wrong for people to just talk about female issues either. I think that if men want advocacy, come join us. You know, like, I spend a lot of my time reaching out to men to try to get them to help us support male survivors of sexual violence, and they're not there. You know, so it's like,
I think what happens is that a lot of men, not a lot of men, but there are some men out there who end up becoming activists for men's issues, and those groups are always demonized and seen as misogynists.
Why do you
pretty much every men's rights?
Why is that?
No, every single men's rights group that I'm aware of has had some sort of hit piece done on them by feminist media. Has done, you know, sort of interviews on television in which they're placed as this misogynist group that hates women, so they're advocating for men's issues, and men's issues don't even need to be advocated for, so why are they talking? That's always the impression that I get, if not the impression a lot of people get. Sort of the MRA is seen as like a dirty word. It's basically synonymous with misogynist at this point, the way people use it. So I think what happens is these men do, I think a lot of men don't care, to be honest, to be activists in that way, but the ones that do, they typically get demonized, and so they're really not a part of the conversation. I guess the only way for them to be a part of the conversation is to be feminists, but the perception that a lot of these people have, you're saying like, come join us, I'm sure you mean like,
well, those groups aren't necessarily feminist groups, they're just like sexual violence groups. They're often feminist groups, but not like, we're feminists, you know?
Yeah. I mean, there's off there, but
I have two thoughts on the men's rights groups being dismissed, and you know, I'm not super familiar with the realm, but my experience is that I've seen people who go under this guise advocating against, like, their platform is actually against women explicitly, which I think, even if there is like a legitimate male advocacy going on, you can't trample on other people, right? Like, that's harmful. And so that can definitely kind of crush the conversation. You can't just attack women or, you know, say this fucked up stuff about women and expect to be supported. I also think that, you know, some of the things that I've seen them, the ways that I've seen them argue about it, is pretty sexist, like calling women bitches and cunts, and you know, this really vitriolic sort of discourse. It's no wonder people don't want to work with them. Like, you have to be a civil human. We're all human beings here, you know?
No, I agree with that. There are people who I feel like on both sides just go crazy, and it's just more of like a war between the two sides rather than to get anything done. But there are also groups that, you know, try to get things done and still get labeled and placed in that category. as
feminists, for instance. I think feminists get placed in that category too. It's a super, and we were talking about this, right? Like the tribalist, the tribalism of these conversations that makes it hard to talk to each other.
Yeah. And then in a lot of instances though, from my perspective, when I look at a lot of feminists, it does very much involve specifically feminist ideology does a lot of ways, you know, involve sort of an adversarial relationship with men, sort of.
I disagree. As someone who regularly fucks with, hangs out with, and loves men, I disagree. I do see some people who feel that way though, like for sure. There's, you know.
No, yeah, I'm not saying you. I'm not saying you, but I'm saying that in terms of feminism, it does often breed a very adversarial relationship with men. It becomes, you know, I'm in this space and there's men all around me and I feel threatened and you know, they're doing this and it's a threat to my space. And I don't know, it's very unhealthy to me when I see it. And so yeah. I mean, I know you.
Where have you seen it? Like, what was your experience like with that?
Okay, so I had all of these friends of mine about a year and a half ago. And it was basically like this house known as like, the way I called it was like the feminist house because it everyone that lived there.
Right, by your video. Is this the same house?
It's a different house, but it's friends of the people I lived with.
Oh, wow. You had many feminist houses, it sounds like.
Yes, well, two. But there was like four or five roommates there and they were all lesbians technically, but some of them identified as non-binary and stuff. And I mean, it really was just a never ending conversation when I went there of, you know, basically hating men and basically saying that, you know, cis people are the root of all evil, straight people are the root of all evil. Mm-hmm. I think that's a little too common for me to be comfortable with within feminism.
That's fair. Can I like speak to that a little bit? Yeah. I've also experienced some of that. And in studying sexuality, I have come across sort of an understanding about people's sexual and gender identities where people kind of go through a process. You know, there's this, I wish I remember the name of it. If you're interested, I can send it to you. But basically there's this process of coming out or process of dealing with your environment for people who are gay or lesbian, LGBT. And part of that process, people developmentally in a pretty consistent way, experience a lot of anger. They have a lot of anger and that is part of their process of healing from living in kind of a fucked up environment or having like fucked up parents, school experiences, work experiences, things like that. And I'm not saying this to like say that's okay, because I personally do not feel like people should be abusive toward others ever. But I do feel like there is something here where you're saying it's common, and that's because it is. People go through in their process of their identity and in their politics of being very angry. And that doesn't usually last forever. It usually goes away. I used to be very angry. Like if you look at some of my old videos, it was a lot angrier, like about religion usually. I was very angry about religion because I was raised in a Mormon Islamic like household and you know, it's just like fucked up. In my experience, it was fucked up. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that you're right, people are angry, and that it's not always productive and it can be really alienating, but I feel like there's a process that people go through. And for me, I just give space to it, even if it's frustrating, you know, because I was there, like I was in it and I'm like, ah, yeah, I like had that feeling. People need a chance to heal.
Yeah, but there's something to that for sure. But I think that there's also something to be said about the fact that so many of the classes that one takes in college can sort of breed that attitude as well. I mean, if you are someone struggling with their sexuality, whatever, and you take a gender studies course and you start reading about, you know, the different things that gender studies courses teach you, inequalities, perceived inequalities, it turns into this, you know, fuck men, fuck the world type of thing. And
right. It validates the anger. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, it feeds it and it validates it and it breeds it and makes it grow, basically, is what
I hear that. I think that anger is part of feminism because it's part of people's process and kind of figuring out their world. It's figuring out their identity. It's figuring out how to be an advocate, how to be an ally, or to be authentic to themselves in any number of capacities. And this is for everyone, not just like women and LGBT people. And I think that anger is okay. I'm not saying that it's like super productive. It can be productive insofar as it helps people in their process. But it, yeah, it's a real thing. It's there. And I just sit with it. People get angry at me all the time. And I'm like, please continue being angry at me. I get it all out because I can take it. I'm okay. You know, I want you to be okay. That's my concern.
Is there any way that you can think of that can change that? Or is that just going to be what it's going to be? And
well, you know, the research on this suggests that it's just kind of there. Like, people who realize they're gay and they come out in a society that doesn't see them as like completely legitimate, people who, particularly for people who are in these really restrictive environments, and for women too, to some capacity, the various experiences of being like treated differently because of who you are, right? That's kind of like been very well documented. So my impression is that yes, it's gonna happen. Can we curb it? Can we create productive spaces to deal with it? Yes, and we should. And maybe we're not doing that very effectively. You know, maybe the internet is not great because the internet becomes in this sense, the internet's great, but it's not great in this sense because for whether it's someone who's dealing with their identity stuff or not, whoever it may be, anger of any kind is much more easily and freely expressed online. And we all know how destructive it can be.
I guess it's, I see a lot of people who may have not been so angry at the world that then go through sociology courses, gender studies courses, feminist studies courses, and then they become very angry.
Well, that's part of getting woke, girl. You got to be this is fucked up.
Not necessarily. I mean, I've been through all of those courses, and I feel like they attempted to wake me into a damn dream, like put me back to sleep.
Fair enough. I think that's valid, but I think that, I guess what I'm getting at is that anger doesn't make me uncomfortable. And that when I'm looking at someone's anger, I want to understand where it comes from. And if I can understand where it comes from and contextualize it, it helps me to better deal with it. And if it's affecting my life in some way, it can help me like deal with that. That's not to say that it's on me or people who are on the receiving ends of hateful abuse are responsible for it. Absolutely not. I'm talking about a different thing. You know, I'm talking about people just having some anger in the feminist community. You know, I think I'm okay with it. I can sit with it. I still am a little uncomfortable with it sometimes. I was more uncomfortable with it at one point, but I do feel like as you get older, people, you know, come into their own and it's not as angry.
Maybe. I'm not necessarily uncomfortable with it. I just think that it often, because anger can be blinding, you know?
Sure.
And you can, in a sense, go in the opposite direction than you're actually trying to.
For sure. No doubt about it.
Yeah. Fighting for equality then turns into believing that masculinity is toxic and men are inherently going to be your enemy. And
pronoun usage
needs to be legislated in the workplace, and people need to lose their jobs if they can't call someone by a certain pronoun. Like, to me, the anger just becomes, like I said, blinding.
Yeah, I mean, I can see how things get a little like out of control sometimes, and I feel that way not just about like this identity stuff, but about like the conversation online in general. It's just like everyone. Maybe it's just my Cali chill, you know? It's like, everyone, can we just sit around a campfire, smoke a joint, calm down, you know? Like, let's talk about this. Let's just talk it out. But those feelings are real. That anger comes from a real place, you know? And so we have to identify where it comes from, if it's valid, how to deal with it, things like that.
Yeah, I can agree that it sometimes just blows into something way more than it needs to be.
On both sides too. I think I was telling you, people post stuff all over the internet about me, saying things about me that I literally never said, that I literally never did, just sort of drawing, Laci must support this because here's what these random people in this place are doing, therefore, blah, you know, it's just like, what? let's,
yeah, I mean,
let's be a little more level-headed about this, you know?
Yeah, I can relate to you on that front, being someone who often gets associated with the word Nazi or with the word fascist.
Have you said Nazi fascist things? Or are they putting it in your mouth?
No. Have you ever seen me say anything Nazi-ish from what you've watched my content?
I know you've made videos about race, but I haven't watched them. So in your gender videos. No, but that's not to say that maybe I would take issue with something that you said.
I mean, you can take issue, but then, you know, saying someone's a Nazi is a whole other level.
You mean the label, like using the strong labels?
Yeah, I mean,
labels.
I mean, if you just take away how stupid it is to call a transgender person a Nazi, it's a pretty horrible thing to call someone. It's like racist times 10. Like, it's like you want to exterminate people and, you know, et cetera. So.
Do you feel the same way about other sort of labels, like being called racist or being called, I know you've been called transphobic, you know, things like that.
The word racist and transphobic really doesn't bother me. The only one that really bothers me, and I'm coming off of it now, getting bothered by it, is the word Nazi. When it comes to being called racist, it's like, I've seen an article in which, I mean, there are people saying that, like, that hurricane in 2016 was racist, environmental racism.
I don't know much about that.
Yeah, people were saying weather is racist. There was a CNN article. Someone was talking about how money is racist.
There's got to be like some reason for that. On its surface, it sounds absurd, but there's got to be something more to that argument, right?
No, there's always more to it, but it's always dumb. I'm just saying. but I'm saying the
there's
word.
There's a lot there. It's just all fucking stupid.
Yes. I mean, it's just so overused at this point that it doesn't matter. You know what I mean?
I hear you. I think that, you know, I'm not going to take a stance on how people label you. I think, like, that's, you know, their prerogative, and maybe you said something that pissed them off or that was harmful. But I do, on the topic of just, like, throwing around these labels and words, I think that it can be overdone and that it is easy. I've done it myself. Like, I've overused these words, and it shuts down the conversation, and it makes it hard for people to hear each other when you accuse someone of being XYZ. And, you know, the sort of amongst my activist friends, they would say, well, you know what, they need to not be, that's their ego. You know, they need to like pay attention. They need to acknowledge what they're saying and do some introspection. Right. And that would be the hope. But I do feel like there are in all activism, there's a psychological element, just like the survivor stuff. There's a psychological element that informs how we respond to things. And, you know, for me, if we can accommodate people's sort of experience and how they experience these conversations, I will do it. I don't expect other people to do it. And I don't think it makes them bad people either. But, you know, I agree with you that let's use our language strategically.
Yeah, and it's also more often than not just an attempt to, well, if I put this person in this box, then there's no sense in listening to them. Like, what sense is there in engaging with or debating with someone who is a racist or is a Nazi or is a misogynist?
And
in the same instance, I'll say, you know, I've gotten a lot of tweets in the past 2 days about this stream saying that there's no sense in engaging with you because you're, you know, a blind feminist and fucking, you know, you're
a feminazi, right? we share the Nazi label. I am a feminazi. Just add a fem at the front.
Oh yeah, I forgot. I guess so. But yeah, it's the aspect of writing someone off and saying I don't have to engage with them because they are this person, and so it would be useless. Mm-hmm. But I think that we can relate on. I think we also relate on this whole thing of like trying to discredit someone based on things that don't actually discredit them, like finding like old footage or pictures or, you know, posting things to embarrass people.
Oh God, that's the story of my life. Like it's when you've been on the internet since you were 17, it's like, of course I said and did dumb shit. Like, why is this news, you know?
Yeah, you know what's crazy is I've only been doing YouTube for about a year and a couple months, but you know, everyone's, I'm, 23. I've used internet forever. And so anything I've ever done, people have found, and it's kind of crazy. And
yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, I can really relate to that feeling. I don't know if you're aware, but when I was younger, I made this video to Chris Crocker. Do you know who that is?
Yeah. We got in a fight the other day. Not a physical.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah. Well, I think he's hilarious. And, I love a lot of the things about his attitude that I like about yours, which is just sort of unapologetic. I have my opinions, you know, I will be respected even if we disagree. And, you know, I just kind of, I'm attracted to that energy, and I've kind of, I've loved Chris for a long time, but I made this video, a fan video to him, and he used to describe himself as a T word. And I used the T word in the video. I used it in the video when I was, you know, 17 or 18, and did not realize that that was a derogatory term, and I didn't use it in a derogatory way, you know, but
I didn't,
and, you know, people, it was so bad. It was seriously so bad. People, like, I had to move. People were taking pictures of my house. People were harassing me online nonstop for this video. Like, literally just for that video.
Wait, because you said the word tranny, people were trying to, like, come to your house and shit.
Destroy my life. They were trying to destroy my life. And I fucked up. Like, I shouldn't have said that, and I didn't know. I was, like a kid from the California suburbs. Like, super, like, we don't talk about this shit. And it wasn't, you know, I didn't mean to. And I acknowledged the hurt that I caused, and that people saw me as someone that they could trust and that they could be comfortable with. And that video challenged that. But the reaction was so disproportionate, right? So disproportionate. And I feel like my experience is that conversations online go from 0 to 100 so fast.
And it's like fast. And it just stacks and stacks, especially with things like
it's Twitter. Like there's no getting out of it. Yeah, it's just like this cycle, and you just fall down this black hole, and you're like, somebody help me, get me out of here. It's so bad. And, you know, I wish we could change that in these conversations. I wish that would, it comes from all sides. It comes from, like, every political affiliation in my experience.
But. Yeah. But I will say sort of that, you know what? Yeah. I was going to say that it maybe happens disproportionately from feminist social justice circles, but actually I think that kind of both sides, I'm not some, like, rampant centrist. I'm not a fence sitter. I do not sit in the middle for the sake of not pissing one off, but I think it is definitely prevalent on both sides. I think we saw recently with, did you see how Tommy Lahren just got, like, brutalized by her own party for having one opinion that wasn't, you know, in party line, which I thought was crazy.
Yeah, that was a pretty weird thing to watch, because, like, the whole premise of that network, like the Blaze and stuff, everything they talk about, they're like, we're about free speech, we're about, you know, speaking our truth and sticking truth to power. And then the moment she says something that they don't agree with, it's just like, that's bullshit, you know. And I disagree with it when anyone does that. It doesn't matter what side of the political spectrum it's coming from. I've had that done to me too. I've also I feel like I've endured, like, many these things in a very public sense, because I learned about my feminism while I was also making videos online, and, like, people, you know, were not always very forgiving of my process. So maybe I'm overly, some of my friends say I'm overly forgiving and overly optimistic about people, maybe about you, but I really feel like we have to give people a chance. And, you know, people say fucked up stuff, and they do fucked up stuff. And there is a line, you know, I don't know where the exact line is for everything, and everyone has a different line. Mine's going to be different from someone else. But for me, maybe my line's a little further. Like, I think we need to talk. Like, I think we need to engage with people's thoughts. And if we're, the main thing that really gets me is the language, the like, really, and I know you feel this way too, like the intense policing of language. You sound like you had a thought on that one, or you look like you had a thought on that one.
I just think it's, like, insane that you went through all that just for saying the word tranny. I mean, it's not even, there's not even some kind of consensus within the trans community that that's even, like, a slur. Like, half of trans people use it. I use it all the time. I actually think it's like a cute and funny word. Like, I don't care.
Yeah. Yeah. I respect that people use it differently.
Yeah. And then there are some people who like equate it to the N-word, which I think is ridiculous because the N-word has a lot of history. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, but at the same time, I also understand why it's a really hurtful word for people. Like, I have since, I think, sort of been, my eyes have been open to some of the implications and meaning behind that word for people. And that's a real thing. You know, I'm, that's where I see the upset and why I think people have a right to be pissed off at me and to tell me, knock that shit off, Laci Green. But, you know, harassing me for months on end.
Yeah. They have a right to be pissed off for sure, but I think people just need to stop being so fucking sensitive, bottom line. Like, if you're that worked up about a word, especially when you said you were young, you said it was in reference to someone who always called themselves that. Like I know my supporters often call me by that word because I use it, and the thought that some of them probably catch hell for it, like, upsets me, so.
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, look, I agree with some aspects of your saying. I also do feel like I kind of fucked up on that because I teach sex ed and like that was not appropriate and not okay. But I also just connected to the bigger picture here about an overemphasis on, you know, nitpicking people's language and then, you know, sort of escalating arguments really quickly without really trying to understand someone's perspective is damaging. And I think it's, you know, kind of related to what we're doing here right now, because the conversation between the feminist community on YouTube and the anti-feminist community is so disconnected in my view.
Rare. So rare. This is incredibly rare.
Why do you think that is?
I think just because, especially now, I mean, I can't speak to, I've only been doing this for a year. I know that the feminist, anti-feminist battle has been going on since like 2013. But it is so polarized, especially now. Times are so polarized. And I think I know exactly why people don't have these conversations, because having promoted this for a few days, the reaction I got was crazy. You saw the tweets, you saw what people were saying, like.
Wait, were people really coming down hard on you? I didn't look at it that intensely.
The majority of people were absolutely ecstatic that this was happening, but okay. There was a segment of people who were like, why would you do that? Like, it's a waste of time. Like, you know, this is the end of your YouTube because you're inviting her into this, you know, club.
So weird.
And it's kind of like, it's so stupid, especially because a lot of the times, you know, we criticize, you know, feminists and social justice warriors for living in an echo chamber. And then it becomes, well, why are you inviting her into our better echo chamber? It's like, girl, yeah, like, stop.
That good old tribalism is back to save the day.
Yeah, you can't escape it, I swear to God. And what's crazy is, I don't know, people can put me in whatever box they want to put me in, whether you want to say I'm an anti-SJW, whether I'm a Nazi, whatever. I have never ascribed myself to a certain group. I've always just been myself as a person with a YouTube and an opinion. Mm-hmm. So the fact that like I'm pitted against certain groups, I think is just kind of funny, because I'm willing to host anyone. And you're not the first person with, you know, similar ideas that I've hosted. Mm-hmm. I know you're not exactly like Indigo Fox or anything, but.
Well, yeah, there's nuances in the argument. I think that's really interesting because it comes from all sides. Mm-hmm. Do you, one of the things I was wondering just while I was thinking about this talk was, you know, do you think that your community would treat you, I was thinking about if my community would treat me differently, if I conceded on some of the things that you express and feel, do you think yours would treat you differently or kind of like give you shit for evolving your perspectives?
I don't think so. I think that, you know, when I started my YouTube, I had no idea that there was this community of like countercultural, you know, anti-social justice people. Like, I thought I was walking into like the lion's den on YouTube and no one else talked about these things.
Oh, girl. Yeah. And there's so like hundreds of people.
Yeah. And so then I came across this community. I'm like, oh, this is like a thing. Mm-hmm. And I think that my side often gets, kind of labeled as like an anti-trans type of thing, whatever have you. But I think that the amount of support and success I've had like in that sphere kind of speaks for itself. I think people are willing to change. I mean, listen, if I suddenly went like full Laci Green and started making feminist videos, I would definitely lose a lot of my audience.
Well, that's not what I mean. I just mean, like, is there, the question that I'm getting at is there room for all of us in this community to grow? Is there room for us as public figures? We're having this conversation that's very public, which informs the context of our conversation and how we have this conversation. Is there even room for any of us to have nuances in our opinion? And I feel like the answer to that is no. Not necessarily even from my community. I feel like, you know, there's a lot of nuance. Like I said, there's a lot of different types of feminism online. And my audience tends to be slightly younger. You know, I have a slightly different relationship with them than a lot of other like commentary YouTubers. But I feel like from other parts of the spectrum, you know, there is no way to ever be something different. Once you've been put in this box, that's all you are. You are reduced to this like idea that I've ascribed to feminism in this case. Yeah. And you are the face of it now, right? Like, you are feminism. Yeah. That's how I feel, you know?
No, yeah, I feel that way as well, actually. I make the content that I want to make. And if I ever switch to a different theme for my channel, then, you know, that'll be what happens. But there is this definite feeling like the videos I put out must be in a certain fashion on a certain topic.
Yeah. I think we all feel that pressure because yeah, you know, and you know that your audience can expect it from you, you know?
Yeah. And it's not that I'm, especially when you add in the fact that like I make a living off of YouTube, it's like if I switch topics and stuff, I would probably get less views, like, et cetera. You know what I mean?
Maybe. But, or maybe we would get more. When I switched, my views went up by like 1,000%. So
yeah, well, there's always that chance. But I feel that pressure as well. Not that I, not to the point where I become like intellectually dishonest and I only, you know, say certain things because.
Sure. But the pressure is real, right?
Yeah. Cause I hate people like that. And I see people like that and it's almost like super transparent. Like, oh girl, you're just saying this cause you know.
Mm-hmm. I guess that is a plea. From me, that's a plea to the internet as a whole to let us have nuances in our opinions, to let us fuck up, to let us grow, to let us express our opinions and have those opinions be respected as our own and engage with them. And I guess one of the other things that kind of bothers me about the conversation is that it's really hard for me to engage when people are so vitriolic. Like when people who hold different opinions are screaming at the camera, using really derogatory language, you know, mocking people, making fun of how they look, this just total like lack, all of the videos that I've seen outside of yours, although, you know, maybe you and I both kind of veer in that territory sometimes too. But I just feel like that is not that's not an argument. That's someone just screaming at a camera. That's not a conversation. You know, that's bullying. Bullying. Yeah, there's a lot of bullying, you know?
There are some content creators who are less interested in having an honest, you know, engagement of ideas and more interested in like wrecking people online for internet points, which I think is stupid. And I don't watch channels like that.
Don't you like kind of sometimes do the little, I mean, I will appreciate, like I said, I have a soft spot for a little bit of pettiness, but don't you kind of do that sometimes too?
Oh yeah. For sure. I occasionally, you know, I think of it as like humor. Like I don't ever just genuinely sit in front of a camera and be like, you stupid mother effer. Like you're so
it's a different style. It's a different style.
If I do it, it's going to be as a joke. Like one time I made a video and there was this girl with this red hair and she made some kind of comment and in the response video, I was like, and your hair looks like eczema. Like, to me, it was more of a joke. It wasn't like trying to destroy her or something. Cause it was like, it wasn't like naturally red hair. It was like this dyed, like insane color. That was how I don't feel like I was trying to like destroy. Like I would never, you know, say someone is like fat or disgusting or.
I know, I've observed your poking, prodding style and I get it. I do feel like, you know, as someone who wants to have a friendship with you and talk to you more about this stuff, because I've learned a lot from this conversation, not just for you, but for people in general. Like if we're really gonna have this conversation, we gotta stop the mocking and the bullying. Because even, I understand it's meant to be all in good fun, And sometimes it is. Like, some of the stuff that I've seen people say about me, I can laugh at it. You know, it's not like it's, my life is ruined. But there is an aggressiveness that comes with some attacks of particular users, who I'm sure we all have in our minds right now, that is just so over the top. It's like, how are they supposed to even engage with this conversation? The bullying is out of this world. Like, I've never seen anything like it, you know? And I just wonder, does it need to be like that? Do these opinions and feelings need to be expressed in such a mean, cruel way?
Yeah, I mean,
I don't think it does, you know?
Yeah, like I said, there are certain content creators where their MO is just to destroy a person, and others who it's to debunk, debate, engage, etc. And then some who are kind of in the middle, I would say probably like myself, who I have the intention of engaging with ideas, but I'll also throw in petty, what I believe to be your like humorous remarks.
Yeah, and but I don't see the problem with that. It's only when it's bullying, like piling onto someone who has like a pile on, right? Like the context matters, and I don't think every single situation is the same, but it does, it makes me sad. It really does.
And then it's up to the person who, you know, may or may not have those videos made about them to kind of decipher and figure out who is worth engaging with. Because because as much as I do not like users like Riley Dennis, and as much as I will argue against them and occasionally prod them, etc., even I can admit there are some videos that are like literally just dedicated to like destroying him as a person and like, you know, just being as evil as possible.
Her as a person. Come on, Blaire. Don't be an asshole.
No. I don't see it as me being an asshole, because Riley
is a woman.
Here's my view on pronouns, and this is what we're going to get into, but here's my view on pronouns. Pronouns need to be very much organic, and they just happen, and you shouldn't have to think about them. And for me, it's very unnatural to refer to Riley Dennis as a woman, and because I don't perceive Riley Dennis to be that, because Riley refuses to transition or really assume the appearance of one at all. And so if
I would dispute all of those claims, but continue.
I mean, you can't dispute that he won't transition, because Riley won't transition. Riley has
not said. It's not my place to talk about her life or her situation, but even if she wasn't transitioning in the way that you did, you know, it doesn't necessarily mean that she is not a woman. You know, like transitioning does not a woman make, right? It is about identity, as you yourself stated earlier.
But there's a transition, and there's not. Like, it's not really like, this is a way of transitioning, this is a different way of transitioning. It's like, Riley has done nothing to transition medically whatsoever, and has stated that Riley will not.
So, I don't know Riley's, it's not my place to speak on Riley's behalf, but even if she hadn't, I still think, you know, even if you disagree, like we could get into how you're defining transitioning and all that, and that's fine. But even if we disagree on that, isn't it just respectful kindness, human kindness, to treat someone, to call someone by the pronouns that they have asked?
I mean, yeah. And if I was in a room with Riley and Riley made it clear to me, this is what Riley wanted, I would probably.
But not online. Come on, we're in rooms right now. You're in a room. I'm in a room, and we're on the internet. No.
It's not even just the online thing. It's the, if I walked past Riley Dennis on the street, if you walked past Riley Dennis on the street, would you know to say she?
I personally would say yes, or I would just not assume. You know, I tend to just kind of, if I'm not sure, and even when I am sure, if I'm in a space where, you know, these are things that we want to make sure that people feel comfortable, I'd go to extra lengths to do that, because I don't want to be an asshole. I realize that it's like a little bit, I have to maybe think for like two extra seconds or whatever, but I personally don't find it that hard. And I think the damage and the meanness, like the cruelness of it, is really what it comes down to for me. It's just like, oh, that's so mean. Like, that's bullying. And like, when I talk to kids who are in high school and stuff, who are struggling with these kinds of things, and they see this online, and this shapes their perspective of the world and how they're going to be treated. And I'm not saying we need to live in a perfect utopia, but I think where there are opportunities for human kindness, we should embrace them, you know?
No, I understand your perspective on that. My perspective is just that the way I view Riley is going to be different than the way you view Riley, because I am trans, and the way I view Riley is someone who, in a lot of ways, whether Riley's intentions are good or not, I think Riley does a lot of harm to trans people by spreading ideas that are non-scientific, that are actually contradictory to ways in which people can actually embrace trans people. And I think that my perception of Riley is that Riley lived a completely, normal life up until, and this is what Riley has admitted, that Riley went to college, learned what non-binary was, and decided that that was for Riley, and has never transitioned, says that he doesn't want to transition. And so for me, it's like, how am I supposed to perceive you as that?
So
because I'm always going to slip up, because I can't perceive Riley in that light, I'm always going to slip up. So I would rather just, how I perceive you is what I'm going to call you. But I will say, obviously, if I'm in a room, I'm not going to intentionally go out of my way to be rude.
See, I just feel like if you can,
but if I'm on the street, but if I'm on the street and walk past someone that looks like Riley or Riley themselves, I'm going to automatically say he. If I'm talking about Riley to someone else, I'm not going to remember that. I'm going to say he. So you know what? I could be nicer and take the opportunity.
When you can, it would be nice. And it's not just about Riley, although it is about Riley. It's about setting a tone of acceptance and kindness on YouTube in our communities. And you can spar to the ends of the earth with Riley about your differences and perspective. And, that's great. But when it comes into like personal attacks and stuff, that's where I just feel so uncomfortable. And I want these conversations to happen, and I want them to be approachable and accessible, and I want us to figure this stuff out, And that can't happen.
But I guess what you see as a personal attack isn't what I see as a personal attack. I don't see calling Riley he as a personal attack. Being someone who routinely by, people who know that I'm trans online, they'll refer to me that way. I just don't care. I guess maybe I am putting how I feel and assuming that's how Riley feels, even though technically I know Riley probably is annoyed when people misgender.
I appreciate you giving a little leeway there. I just wanted to plant a seed to think about, not even necessarily just about Riley. I understand where you're coming from, and I get your brand of humor and all of that. But that aside, I want to continue talking. I want to learn from you. I want to share ideas. I want to share research and things like that and learn more truth. And I want that to be something that is accessible for everyone. And when it's vitriolic and mean and cruel for no reason, that's a problem. That's all I'm saying. No, please think about it. I will personally feel, very grateful to you for being just respecting people as they want to be respected. And I hope that you felt like I did that for you in this conversation as well.
No, you did. And I could absolutely be less petty with Riley.
I'm not saying don't be less petty, because it's hilarious, but the meanness, the cruelness.
I guess that's just a matter of how we perceive meanness and cruelness then, because
I think the misgendering, the intentional, it is, come on, there's like, I've seen you guys, some of the tweets and stuff, it's mean, and there are trans kids out there who are, feeling pretty bad about that, and I'm not saying safe space for everyone, okay, everyone calm down, who's gonna, whatever, everyone gets all mad about that. I'm saying we are YouTubers. This is our world. This is our community. Let's disagree. Let's spar it out. Let's get heated, but let's not dehumanize and attack each other while we're doing it. That's my feels.
Yeah. And my only thought is that I don't perceive it as an attack or dehumanization. So,
all right. Well, I would encourage you to think about it. Will you do that? Will you do that much for me?
I could absolutely concede that it's unnecessary and that I technically could go out of my way to say she for Riley, but okay. I would have to be going out of my way, but I could technically do it. I could.
If you want, I'll go out of my way for something on your behalf. If that would make us even, you think about how the language we use to talk to people and engage with people, what would you like me to think about from this conversation?
I don't know. I feel like we talked about everything.
Okay. Well, if something comes up, you know where to find me. Tweet me.
I do. I will tweet you. I will DM you.
Okay. I appreciate it, Blaire. I would like to talk again. Frankly, I feel like we only scraped the surface on the gender stuff. We didn't even get to non-binary genders. So,
yeah. And we kind of go a long time and we still only scraped the surface. So.
Well, but these are long conversations. I have had, there's entire like semesters on this stuff. So it's not like, you know, an hour and we're done. But, yeah. I am interested in further understanding your perspective, particularly on the gender stuff. And the feminist activism and how we can make this community more productive and welcoming.
For sure. And, you know, thank you for coming on. Cause like I said, this is rare and I think it's valuable and it was fun.
Yeah. Yeah. I am, anytime you want to talk again publicly or not, I'm here. Hit me up.
Awesome. Okay. So everyone, you probably know where to follow Laci Green. Just Google her.
Thank you. Kind anti-feminist people, I will go back into my social justice warrior cave now and think about this conversation. Thank you for educating me.
Thanks for coming. Bye, everyone.
Bye, Blaire.